Get the Stake podcast daily at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
We're dealing with a couple of items this morning. Number one, Craig Miller was listed as either questionable or doubtful going into today's show because of laryngitis. So let's give Junior a chance to test out the voice here at 5:36 on the ticket.
Good morning.
Sounds good.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah. Good morning, Dallas-Fort Worth.
Okay.
Nice.
Yeah.
That'll work.
Sounds a little different, just a little deeper and froggy.
I'm happy to be with you today.
We're happy to have you.
And I'm looking forward to a good show.
Good Lord, you got deep voice.
And I'm looking forward to a good show.
You kind of sound like Bochy.
Oh, yeah, we do.
So yesterday at 3 p.m., I could not speak.
Nothing came out.
Nothing came out. By last night, it was a little better than this. And I woke up and it was almost completely gone. But I've been drinking tea and coffee. And I decided to come in and we'll just see how long it lasts. It might only make it to 6.
Yeah.
But it might, it might make it to 10.
Boy, that's rough. That's wild that you had the vid a couple of weeks ago. My sister went through the same thing. She had COVID, and then like a week later, she had the same thing. She had laryngitis. I don't know if it was the same head cold that you got or whatever, but yeah, she went through the same thing, and she went through about 2 or 3 days where she could not talk.
I've had a ridiculous 3 weeks. COVID, horrific head cold, and now laryngitis out of the head cold.
That's a lot.
I'm not doing well. Hey, and I appreciate you guys visiting me.
Hopefully they keep you comfortable, pal.
Yeah, I tell you what, we brought you some,
is there anything
some
we can
crackers
do?
And soup, and we're just going to mosey on out.
Yeah,
and
we're going to get going.
No,
let
please,
you rest.
Can you please stay?
No, I think they're ready to give you your bath.
No, they're abusing me here. Please stay.
Well, they're pretty nice. I think they're pretty nice.
No, they're not. Yeah. When you leave, they hit me.
Oh, no, it's okay, though.
Gosh.
That's okay. They know best.
Okay.
I'm just trying to help your voice.
When you leave, they hit me. That's the name of your autobiography.
What a disturbing twist that took.
Well, thank you guys for visiting.
Yeah, but, we got your TV on, so I think we're good. And
so here's the conundrum, because last night we had Rich Phillips ready on standby to fill in for me. And I told Kat, well, what if I wake up and I have, a good voice? And then Rich comes in, and I'm just sitting at home with a good voice and all sorts of HSOs. So I didn't know what to tell him. And he said, no, we have to tell Rich tonight. He has to know tonight. I was like, well, let's just cross our fingers and maybe I'll have a good voice. But maybe
Maybe I made
the wrong call.
No, you're nailing it.
Yeah, you know how we've always done it. It's up to you. Personally, I feel like you need just a day of nothing.
Yeah.
And I know you had a couple of days like that over the weekend where you didn't feel well, but, doing the show yesterday, and it's not as if we do like a 45-minute show. It's 4.5 hours. That's a lot on your voice.
You know, it was the last hour that killed me. If we had stopped at 9, I think I would have been okay today, but I noticed throughout the 9 o'clock hour my voice going, and in crosstalk, it was like really going.
Yeah.
Like I couldn't even close the show.
Yeah.
I've always found, though, that when I come in and my voice is like that, because I have that once a year, it seems
like. We all get it. Yeah.
Then my voice gets stronger throughout the morning.
That's what I was hoping.
Yeah. I'll wake up and go, there's no way I can do the show. And then I come in and do the show, and I start talking, and it seems to get stronger as you go along. So hopefully that'll
maybe yours
be the
will.
Case.
Maybe you'll hit your stride here. When we start talking about Monday Night Football.
Yeah, I feel like my voice right now is at about 97%. But maybe by 6 it'll be at 100%.
Yeah.
Yeah, as long as you don't try to shout,
Yeah. Did I say 97%?
Yeah.
I meant 9%?
I meant 7%.
9.7%.
But at any point, this is a beating to you and or the listeners. You have to tell me to leave.
No, that's okay, buddy.
It's all right. You're doing good. You're doing good.
No. Speaking of,
just to get a pillow and
speaking of beatings, that's what they're doing to me.
No,
here.
So
will you please
weird.
Put a pillow over my face?
They look nice. No, they look really nice. We're going to get out of here.
They're bad people.
They can do their thing to you, buddy.
They're bad people. They don't feed me.
No, they're fine.
Okay.
Please stay.
Stop it. That sounds so awful with that voice. It really sells the dark plot that he's trying to throw out early this morning.
This is a torture chamber.
Stop it.
When you leave, they beat me.
Okay.
They do.
No. Stop it.
Yeah. We've seen it on the little camera we've set up, but, you know, we just assume they know what's going on.
Plus, it's almost deer season, so we got to take that camera somewhere else.
Take care, man. No, fair enough.
You take all kinds of care.
Okay, bye-bye.
All right.
So what have you been drinking, like tea, water? I told you to drink water. That was Pat Green's advice. He says that's what he always does.
Tons of water, tons of tea.
Yeah. A little honey in there.
Yeah, honey, lots of lozenges, gargling salt water, you name it. Soup. This is ridiculous.
It's great. It's great.
Yeah. Maybe we ought to get Rich in the bullpen warming up.
Hey, Rich.
I mean, if he...
Throwing out some NASCAR thing. There he is, warming up.
He's idling.
If Rich, if you're listening, you can come in.
Start throwing some pitches. See what you got, and then, come on in.
I can give him all my HSOs via Morse code, and he could just relay them.
Yeah, just give him the game plan.
Or just text them to him. Or...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I've got a phone.
Email.
Although they took it from me here.
Okay.
So they can't record.
You can't keep going back to what they're doing.
I can't call 911.
Yeah, I don't know.
They don't feed me, and they beat me. What?
It's all true.
It's not funny.
It's all true.
No, it's not funny. It's just truth.
I'm going to have a lozenge right now.
All right.
See, and I've always told, too, you got to be careful with sort of lozenge you use.
Oh, what? Really?
Yeah.
Where'd you get that from?
People. That some really don't. I mean, some may soothe your throat a little bit.
What do you think of that?
It says throat care. They put it on the label unless it cared for your throat.
Yeah, I know. But as far as it relates to your voice, I don't know if those really do much for you.
What does it say?
Yeah, it's got that. It's got a liquid center in it and extra menthol.
Extra menthol.
So, I don't know. And I think once you get to the point where you are, it's... There's not much that can help you.
Well, I appreciate that.
Yeah. Well,
I'll take it out. Put it right there.
Well, no, keep it in if you think it helps. I mean, I don't know.
That was the only sustenance he's had in a week.
That's true.
Because they haven't fed him here.
Okay. Let's reset, and we can't go back to that bit.
Why?
We just can't, so stop.
You want us to wheel you by the window before we leave? Or
yes,
like that?
Please, so I can jump out.
Gosh. Oh, man.
He's in a wheelchair.
Oh, man, just not scoring.
Thank you, Mino, for keeping us up to date there. All right, well, what are you going to do? Are you going to tough it out? Or are you going to... I think you ought to go get in bed. That's my vote.
I think you ought to tough it out. It's fun. It's an adventure.
But it's up to you.
But I'm afraid it's a beating. For the P1.
No, we're having fun with it.
Well,
no.
Not by 8 o'clock.
Yes, by 8 o'clock it's funny.
Uh-oh.
Hey, listen, pal, don't strain yourself,
please,
buddy.
Please don't go.
You may go into wheeze laugh, too.
Please don't go.
You want us to ram your head into the wall before we leave?
Please.
Okay, more of this amazing stuff next. We're trying to make a personnel decision on what to do with Junior. I think the plan is now he's going to stay with us through 6:10, and then we'll make a call. Because he has red-hot sports opinions on the 49ers and Jets.
Red-hot.
We don't want to miss.
two of them you won't be able to handle.
Okay.
Can't wait.
And then after that, you may have to take a knee, or you may just keep going.
That's right.
We don't know which way it's going to go. I feel for you, and I feel like all this is going to move from where it is right now into your chest because I heard just a a hint of wheeze laugh.
And oh, no.
Sounds like we may get, I don't know, maybe a couple of weeks of wheeze laugh out of you. This will be great.
I hope not. I mean, it could be funny, yes. I feel, you know, in terms of my human body, I feel pretty normal.
Yeah.
I've got some congestion still that's beating me down, but I don't feel as bad as I did 3 days ago.
Yeah.
And I haven't had a fever since Saturday. And I'm back to, like, physically, I feel 100%. It's just, I sound like I'm at about 10%.
Yeah, just all settled right there in your vocal cords. Have you ever had the friend that would call up work and sound like you do with effect and then really probably wasn't that sick, you know, but would put on their best sick voice when they would call up? I know for a fact that we've worked with people like that through the years, but yeah, there's no effect on your voice right now. It's like they try to sound as sick as possible when they call up to work to try to get out for a day or two.
Well, I texted our boss to see what he thought. Oh, he finally texted me back.
Oh, no.
So please stop talking to me.
I said, is this unlistenable? He said, it's not unlistenable. It's like Rest Home Junior, LOL. But do people want to hear Rest Home Junior?
Sure they do.
4.5 hours.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. Why not? Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you, guys.
As long as we don't go down that dark path again.
What's the dark path?
You know what it is. All right, it is 6:08.
Kill me.
No, don't kill me. We don't want to do that.
What is your plan? What do you think?
Do you want me here for the corner? I mean, for the ODEC?
Sure. Stick around. It'll be fun.
I think I'll leave then.
All right. What's next in the ODEC?
The thing on the deal next. You bet. I don't feel squared away this morning. And it's because I had to have a panic breakfast.
Well, that is a panic breakfast.
Very Muser breakfast packy. Because I just had to reach inside the snack drawer and grab whatever I could. And so I had a snack bag of Cheez-Its, a snack bag of Ritz, and a Rice Krispie treat. And I hate myself.
What a ridiculous breakfast.
I so deeply and thoroughly hate myself for this. And the only way that I can comfort myself for the shame that I feel is to eat more junk food later today.
Okay.
You know, to
whatever
just,
works.
Yes. Yes. To get that temporary reprieve of the shame spiral, I need to have a big bowl of ice cream. And then
Cheez-Its,
I need to feel bad about
Ritz,
that. And an ice cream treat.
Yeah.
Yes. All of this is food that will still be good 100 years from now if I just left it in storage. That's how you know that you're not doing right by your own. Your own human body. But that's what I ate. But I had it with a nice cup of coffee. That's the other thing. I had it with coffee. You ever had Cheez-Its with coffee?
Never.
Okay. Well, you ought to try it sometime.
What bad, huh?
Oh, yeah. It'll make you feel great about yourself. So you should do it. All right. Get an email from Mark from Fort Worth. He says that he was so sad and disappointed that he listened to Monday Morning Quarterbacking, our 9:15 segment after a Sunday in which a Cowboy football game was played. And he was very depressed because he did not hear the Giorgio Hot Fry Player of the Game Award. And he was the inventor of the Giorgio Hot Fry.
Oh, man.
And he said that's his legacy. And that's all he will ever be known for to himself. Said his life's been a complete waste of time.
Wow.
And he's been a royal failure. Says he has Cheez-Its and coffee for breakfast every morning. And Mark, I have to tell you, you did not listen to the rest of the Musers, because the very next segment with David Moore, that was his very first question. Our sports cowboy expert,
David Ranch,
asked who the Hot Fry Giorgio Player of the Game was. And the answer was Kendricks,
Eric Kendricks.
Eric Kendricks. So there you
Eric. Go. But I heard a complaint about that, that we've taken the human element out of it. But David, but David's a human.
Facts. Human element. What are the things that where it's good to have the human element? There are some things that it's better to have the human element, but there also are a lot of things that people would say that they didn't want what I would call progress on because they wanted the human element. They loved it that people got things wrong.
Customer service? Don't you want to talk to a human?
Yeah, but that's a case where the robots are not better than the humans.
For a long for a long time it was referees and officials.
Yeah. Right. We always used to have that. No, we didn't want. We also used to complain about instant replay. I remember that being a thing when it was like the human element.
That's what I meant.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of the ref getting things wrong. Because it reminds us all that we fall in love and that we have children and that our civilization has not been on this planet very long. The human element. That's what a ref making a wrong down and distance call and then they can't review anything and get things right. So, but there are some things that are better with the human element. The Giorgio Hot Fry Player of the Award is not one of them. We need the robotic David Ranch asking us about it.
I still like the P1 being involved in it.
No, I agree. But it doesn't make it any more human. That's the wrong term for it. Strike zone, that probably needs to go to the robots. Robots can do better there.
Yeah.
How far away are we from that?
At the major league level?
Yeah, major league level.
10 years.
Yeah, that's probably.
You don't think it'll be shorter than that?
No. It'll take a while.
We're not even experimenting in the minors with it yet.
I don't think so. I think it'll be within 5 years. And because baseball recently has shown us a willingness to start changing things. And that leads me to believe that they will consider it.
Yes, and artificial intelligence is getting better rapidly, so you might be right.
Right. So wouldn't it be great to have accurate balls and strikes called?
I don't know. The umpires seem to have some sort of stranglehold on the game that they've just got so much
Dude, they're employees power just like anybody else on that field.
It'll take at least 10 years.
Okay. You know why I don't believe you guys?
Contact me in 5 years.
Because I was once told by you guys, Gordon, you don't understand.
This ought to be good.
Daniel Snyder's never going to allow that team to change their name, okay? it's not going to happen.
I don't know if we tried to have a big battle on a hill over that one.
You threw me against a wall and pressed your forearm against my throat.
I don't know about that.
Yes, you did.
I told you that I'm with you. I think it'll be 5 years, and I'm looking it up, and it looks like we do have it in the minors in some places. They're just testing them.
Right.
They're not, but it's there.
Right.
So they're seeing how it works.
There you go. See, that's an area, Giorgio, where you're going to be comfortable with removing the human element?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not going to fight that.
Ooh, interesting.
Uh-oh.
Major League Baseball sent a memo to all teams, let's see, this is this year, this June, basically telling them that the future of automated balls and strikes is nigh upon us.
See?
Mm. There you go. Told you.
They didn't put any date on it.
They just use the term nigh upon us? That seems weird to put in a memo.
I use that to spice it up a little bit. according to MLB, 61% of team personnel, including players, and 47% of fans favor a challenge system. So you could that's how they're going to start.
Uh-huh.
You're not going to have a robot umpire, but you'll be able to challenge.
The regular umpire. They go to the robo umpire to give you the correct answer.
Yeah.
And then that's the halfway measure that will eventually lead to robo umpire calling everything.
Yeah.
Well, good. It's interesting to me, though, in that stat, that there's a division between players and fans. That the players are more for it than the fans are.
Because they get screwed.
Yeah.
Yeah. And should we trust, defer to their judgment? They're the actual players. They know what's up. They know that it's better to get it actually right.
Yeah.
But the fans are all like, I don't know. I like it when it's wrong for my team, my team's benefit. Get this from P1 Luke. That's the name I'll give him. He says that he is a home builder, and he does remodels, and that as part of his deal, when he gets to do a demolition, he has the salvage rights to the house. So we've been talking about, do you ever find anything in an old house that's worth money? He says that in all his time of doing this demolition and having the rights to anything in the house, he's never found anything that was of much value, except for he found a 2-iron from 1970.
Okay. I don't know and in, much value that
and
has.
In the same house, he found a bunch of Polaroids of a lady in a white bra and panties. And he kept them. He kept the Polaroids.
Huh.
You want to see some old grandma from 1968?
No. Why did he throw those away?
Yes, he should have. He says he salvaged those photos. I don't think you're using that term
salvaging
correctly. Yeah, that is wrong of you to keep those. P1 Tony says, it's annoying me more and more, the initials that they use on broadcast. Talking to EA and KB and TB and the thing that I was complaining about yesterday, and you guys agree with me that it's annoying, right?
Yeah.
Junior, I know you do.
Yes.
Tony says that they sound like a bunch of truckers on a CB radio.
Yeah, we don't do that here. We don't call each other GK and CM and
right.
GD and... Hey, coming up next is MM and DL.
It's just so annoying.
Why do they do that?
It's unnecessarily attitudinal. It does not make them sound hip.
No.
Or youthful. It's stupid, and they need to quit doing it. Tony says in other news, did you happen to catch Pam Oliver this weekend?
I didn't see her.
She looked quite spry. So says she looks good, so maybe her relationship troubles.
Good.
That Craig has always speculated about
her
over with.
That's Gordon's line of
Doug thinking. Says, I found the pauses in the broadcast, Tom Brady's unnaturally long pauses. He found them very nice. He says, I get so tired of the constant bantering by the announcers, just droning on and on, that sometimes in the game I will mute the game just to have the announcers shut up. You know, I think you're in the minority there, Doug. I think that people want to hear the announcers talk.
Yeah, not just all of a sudden stop in the middle of a sentence.
Yeah, that was the weird thing Brady would do. He would rear up in the middle of a sentence like he just saw a verbal snake lying in the road, and he had to rear up like a horse, and he would quit talking. He would just be talking along and... And then doorknob sock emails. Can't believe you guys not talk about the big Tom Brady burp that happened in the broadcast.
Yeah, there was. Yeah. We need to review that.
It was when Cooper Rush was coming in to take a knee, and KB asked TB how it feels to be broadcasting a game. Tom said it felt weird, but Michael Strahan told him to be thankful he wouldn't be sore and all that. And then it sounded like he let out the loudest on-air belch. Maybe it was just a weird inhale while he's smiling about what he just said, but it sounds like a belch. You guys need to review it.
Okay.
And that comes to us from Doorknob Sock. So
yeah, anything from Doorknob Sock has got to be good.
So we need to check that out. Daddy, did you hear about that? Or
I have not heard of an actual burp. I heard yesterday with the sweet spot him, you know, like getting voice like this, like he was trying to hold something in, but I haven't heard an actual burp. I'll see if I can find it.
That is an annoying thing you do when you're trying to hold it in. Get all deep voiced and everything.
I remember when we were listening to the studio, we all said that very thing. Did he just burp? But I think he was just like talking up to it like he was about to.
Okay.
I told you guys about the idiocracy that's going on in their post game. Tom Brady interviews whoever it is. Was it Micah?
I think it was Micah, yeah.
As the LFG player of the game.
Which stands for?
Let's blanking go. So that's where we are now with the idiocracy they have on Fox. The LFG
of the game. I missed this. How did the LFG thing start? Why was everybody having to say that on Twitter there for a while?
What do you mean for a while?
Yeah.
It hasn't stopped.
Is it still going on?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
That's a big thing in sports.
Okay, I think I have the burp moment.
Where did
by
that
the way.
Start? Where that started with?
No, I don't know where exactly it started, but I don't know.
All of a sudden, everybody had to say that.
Yeah, it's a beating.
It is. It's kind of a beating to me, but I don't know. Maybe it's very hip.
Yeah, boomers.
Hip and very youthful and young, and it's awesome, and it makes people feel good. So that's good. I'm for it for those reasons, but it is weird. Okay, so we have the audio. Let's hear if Tom Brady burps or is trying to hold a burp in.
Just thinking about that defense. Obviously, there's quality of players in the secondary, but they also have Jordan Hicks at linebacker that they brought over, who's very familiar with Jim Schwartz's scheme. They have Owusu Koramoah at linebacker, had a great year last year. So it's not just one good player, Garrett. It's good players at all three levels of the defense.
Okay, so it does sound like he had a...
slowing down the record or something.
Yeah, he didn't seem to really burp loudly to me. It just sounded like he was about to, or...
They have Koramoah... Excuse me.
Excuse me.
He's the GOAT.
He is.
He is the GOAT, and LFG, the GOAT. So, anyway. All right, so there you go. There is a few observations in the observation deck.
I think Junior's going to check out.
Yeah, I hate to do this, but I feel like if I try to talk until 10 o'clock, I'm going to endanger the rest of the week.
That's okay, buddy.
I don't think my voice has gotten any better since 5:30.
No, it sounds pretty ragged.
So I will leave you with this. Then I hope to be back tomorrow, God willing, on this wall for the P1s for the upcoming segment. Daddy, I couldn't have been more impressed with Texas. I told you in our picks last week, I thought Texas was going to go in there and run away from them.
Boy, they did.
And they did. And I could not have been less impressed. You can use this at 8:15 with my Sooners. They are terrible. They are so bad, at least through these first two games against terrible opponents, that Houston game would have been a top 10 loss in program history. So if Oklahoma doesn't figure something out, and I think they may get their ass kicked by Tulane.
Yeah, Tulane's pretty good.
Texas is going to beat Oklahoma 93-0.
I'm writing that down,
wow,
but I see
is,
what
I
you're doing.
He still has a
I
fever
see what you're
he
doing here, and don't think I don't. All right.
In fact, I don't think there's any way Oklahoma can even score against Texas.
Keep it up.
Yeah.
So,
I would just say don't draw, just like after week one, don't draw a bunch of conclusions after week two.
Have you seen all the stats about OU? They are last in the nation in everything, and they've played two terrible teams.
Yeah, it's a rough start. It's definitely a rough start, but I don't think they're terrible. They've played terrible, and I thought they were worse this week. I thought they were worse this week against Houston.
They're terrible. Right now, they're a terrible football team, and that's how I will leave you. And
I'll leave you alone.
I have to say is have a good show the rest of the way. God bless the ticket, and God bless the United States of America.
Oh, wow. There he goes. There he goes. There goes Laryngitis Jr. It is 6:51 on the ticket.
Now, I call this a huge, notable Hollywood death.
Everybody
you
does.
You said that even his family wouldn't even care that he died.
I don't say things like that.
Very different points of view.
This made me very sad when I heard this yesterday.
Very different. But passing away at the age of 93, which is a very
good long life, you bet,
is the legend James Earl Jones.
God, what a voice. What a warm smile, too. Every character that he played was just so lovable.
Mufasa.
Yeah.
The voice of Darth Vader, which George just called a lovable character.
No, which I said when kind of you saw weird, him on screen, like in The Sandlot or Field of Dreams, he was very lovable.
Passes away at his home at the age of 93. No word on what the cause of death was. George was speculating it was an acquired immune deficiency syndrome.
What is wrong with you?
What
shut
you
up. Just do the story.
Well, we didn't have the cause of death, so.
Well, I didn't say that.
You started speculating.
No,
that's
I didn't.
So, he made his big screen debut in Doctor Strangelove, the Stanley Kubrick movie.
Such a wild movie.
It is a wild movie. It also has one of the longest names, I think, of any movie I've ever seen. It's actually Doctor Strangelove or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb.
That's right.
Came out in 1964. I didn't remember this, but he is a Mississippian.
Huh.
He was born in Mississippi and then moved to Detroit and was raised by his maternal grandparents. And when he was a boy, for those who don't, it's hard to believe that somebody would not be familiar with who James Earl Jones is. He also was the voice of CNN, by the way.
That's right.
This is CNN.
And was from the very beginning. I remember first tuning into CNN when it came out.
Yeah.
Boy, that was forever ago.
Back when they called themselves the most important network in the world.
Did they?
Yes.
And hearing James Earl Jones doing
this is CNN. Mufasa, you have disobeyed me, Simba.
God, he was so great in that.
And here's a soliloquy of Darth Vader talking about baseball.
No.
People will come, Ray. They come to Iowa for reasons they can't even fathom. They turn up your driveway, not knowing for sure why they're doing it. They'll arrive at your door as innocent as children, longing for the past. Of course, we won't mind if you look around, you'll say. It's only $20 per person. They'll pass over the money without even thinking about it. For it is money they have and peace they like.
So great.
And that was directed to Luke when he had his big confrontation.
Him talking baseball. I'm just going to talk over you. Him talking baseball in The Sandlot was great, too, with those kids.
I'm trying to think if I ever saw The Sandlot. I know that's a real classic.
Well, you've
missed
out if you haven't
seen that. Some people swear by that movie.
My boys love that movie growing up. It's really good.
I think it's probably pretty spare, though, isn't it?
No, it's not spare.
Okay.
I would say a top five baseball movie.
Did he reissue those same lines from Field of Dreams?
No, he didn't reissue. He had his own lines. He was a former pitcher.
It was always weird to me in Field of Dreams, his body. Because he had this big belly, but the real skinny waist.
Again, we mourn the loss of one of the greatest voices of all time.
Absolutely, and all that. All that.
What's wrong with you today?
Legend. Nothing's wrong with me today. I had a great, nutritious breakfast.
That's your problem.
Bright-eyed and bushy.
You woke up and you had Ritz crackers, Cheez-Its, and a marshmallow cookie for breakfast.
Okay, that's all made up. That's ridiculous. Where'd you come up with those items from?
From you.
That's silly. His father was an actor, Robert Earl Jones. And his dad was actually blacklisted from the industry by the House Un-American Activities Committee. During the whole, I guess, communist scare thing. But his dad appeared in the movie The Sting, which is a good movie. And I actually enjoyed
this. I haven't seen that one in forever.
But you've seen it. You've seen
The Sting. I've seen it, but I really can't remember much about it.
And The Sting 2. I remember even liking The Sting 2. The Sting 1 was with Robert Redford and Paul Newman, right?
I believe so.
And Robert Shaw, I think.
Former cowboy?
No. That's Robert Upshaw.
That was Robert Newhouse.
No.
Okay.
But then The Sting 2, I think, was with Mac Davis and Jackie Gleason, I think. Hmm. Anyway, we're a little bit far afield from Mufasa.
Great James Earl Jones.
He says he used to do, parents used to confuse their kids when he would meet them. They'd say, hey, this is Mufasa. And the kids were very confused because they're just looking at this tall dude standing here. And they're like, he's not a lion. What are you talking about? And then, of course, he would do the Mufasa voice. And the kids would freak out hearing that big, huge voice coming out of this guy. They're used to seeing the lion talk.
So great.
He also used to get on, in the late 70s, he would get on CB radios and as Darth Vader.
That's great.
Which is a pretty good gag.
Breaker 19.
But he was not credited as Darth Vader, I guess, until the third film.
Really?
Yeah, like he didn't acknowledge that he was the voice of Darth Vader, which is so strange. How he gets the voice of Darth Vader, because that's what I originally knew him from. That's when I was gaining pop culture consciousness, is hearing him, his voice as Darth Vader. I didn't see Dr. Strangelove until I was older. But George Lucas originally wanted Orson Welles to be the voice of Darth Vader.
Huh.
The famous fat wine salesman.
Yeah.
Orson Welles.
Uh-huh.
Who also, I think, did a few movies before then.
Yeah, he did a few.
Like some spare movies 100. That probably weren't even reviewed very well.
Yeah.
But yeah, he wanted Orson Welles.
He would have been good.
Yeah, he would have been good, too. But I think Orson Welles would have been a little bit too hammy or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
And Orson, I guess, either didn't do it or maybe he didn't ask him or whatever. Oh, he considered Orson Welles but felt his voice might be too recognizable. So he called James Earl Jones's agent and asked if his client would like a day's work. So I guess he knocked out all the Darth Vader stuff in one day.
Yeah.
Of recording his thing. And he got $7,000. I mean, here is one of the greatest movie villains of all time.
And he got $7,000.
And he got $7,000 for that first movie.
Whoa.
Which is
hopefully
insane.
He renegotiated for
guaranteed
the rest of it.
And I remember reading a story a few years ago that James Earl Jones had gone into what was then the state-of-the-art voice lab and had them clone his voice.
Oh.
Which is pretty smart to do. I mean, when you have an iconic voice like that, if they can retain the rights over that, his family could make money for years off of his cloned AI voice.
As they should.
Yeah. So James Earl Jones passing away.
I was very sad to hear that.
At the very tender young age of 93.
I'm glad he lived into his 90s.
Yeah, he married his wife, Julianne Marie, in 1968 after meeting during a production of Othello.
Hmm.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah.
They divorced 4 years later, George. No. So, anyway.
All right.
He met his second wife while taping the CBS police drama Paris. They were stars in that. Married in 1982 and had a son, Flynn. She died of ovarian cancer in 2016, George. Yeah. So, anyway, have you watched the Tyreek Hill videos?
Yes.
You have an opinion?
I do.
There's
no doubt Tyreek probably could have been a little more cooperative, but what that police officer does by ripping him out of the car and then forcing him on the ground, and even when he said, "Hey, I've had a knee injury, you know, please be careful," and
didn't the dude go there and like kick him or standing there, and all of a sudden that officer lunges at him.
It was bad. I could see why initially that first policeman was a little upset that he wouldn't cooperate with the window. That's not unreasonable to say, leave your window down. But no, he did not. After that point, he handled it really poorly.
So the video, and Tyreek did an interview with
CNN
on Monday night. He said he was embarrassed and shell-shocked by the situation. But the video shows two motorcycle officers. They go after Hill after he appeared to speed past them in his McLaren sports car. That thing looks so cool.
Yeah, pretty sweet.
While entering the Hard Rock Stadium there, and it was light traffic, and they later said they clocked him at 60 miles an hour. So they turn on their lights, they pull him over, knock on the driver's window. The officer tells him to put his window down, which Hill does that and then hands him his driver's license. But Hill says, don't knock on my window like that. He tells the officer this repeatedly. The officer says, I have to knock to let you know I'm here. And then he's repeatedly asking Tyreek why he's not wearing his seatbelt. And Tyreek says, just give me my ticket, bro, so I can go. I'm going to be late. Do what you got to do. And he says this while putting his window back up.
See, that's what I'm saying. Tyreek could have done better.
Yeah.
He was not
cooperating. The officer says, keep your window down. And he only rolls the window down slightly and says, don't tell me what to do, and then puts it back up. So he claims, though, his argument is that he did roll his window back up, but it was to try to avoid drawing unwanted attention to himself. He says, look, if I let my window down, people walking by.
That makes some sense.
But the officers, of course, don't see it that way.
They see it of what's going on there. It's a really dark window where you can't see in.
Right. But Tyreek is saying, you know, hey, look, people are going to start taking pictures. They're going to create a scene. This sounds so badly managed, and just reading the narrative of this, it is like, okay, you got two people who have two different objectives here, and they're not handling it right. Now, the first officer who originally went there, even Tyreek's lawyer says that guy handled it well. It was this other really aggressive
officer.
Oh,
that was the second guy.
The second guy is the one who was
the one who was
really aggressive.
There's like an hour worth of footage.
Yeah, and the police released six body cams worth of footage. I guess the six officers there. They released all that body cam footage, which they say they normally wouldn't do, but they wanted to appear transparent, you know, and what happened. And one officer has been already placed on administrative leave.
It's disturbing.
It is. And you see how these conflicts, they can just get escalated and sideways really quickly.
Yeah.
And, but I'm going to tell you, man, I've had that feeling of that he's had so many times of the just do the ticket. It's fine.
And there is something about that on your window almost aggressively.
Yeah, they're doing it real aggressive. It's like, and officers have, I've said this before, they've gotten a lot better. I remember I used to come on here and complain about aggressive officers all the time. People used to yell at me, and then feels like culture changed, and then officers did start realizing, you know what, we need to stop. Because officers back in the day, and they probably still do in a lot of places, they make conflict worse rather than the de-escalation thing that's starting to be emphasized now.
Right.
And now I've run into officers who are very good at the de-escalation and keeping the calm tone and everything. They've been taught their Jedi mind tricks, and they work.
Yeah.
When they use them, they work for the most part.
And if you had a...
But I've had them before where they just try to make things worse. The officer, any reason why you think you're so great that you just need to be speeding right now? It's like, okay, the way you worded that question didn't help you or me, and it's designed to get us into an argument.
Right.
Why would you come up and ask it that way?
Yeah.
And then I'd complain about it on the air, and then people would go, you don't stand, man. Policemen are human beings, man. Maybe they had a bad day. Okay. Well, then maybe the motorist also had a bad day. If we're going to do the whole everybody's human, therefore nobody has to act better.
Yes. But as I've said before, we could all do better with maybe not speeding as much.
True.
So they don't have as much to do and keep up with and not give them the long days that
but maybe I've had a bad day, so I'm speeding. Since
okay,
that's the
but a bad day
fair
for a police officer is
say.
A bad day for a police officer could be they just got shot at, they just had to chase someone that pulled a knife on them. They just had to break up a domestic dispute.
Yeah, that's
and
one
now
picture.
We gotta deal
that's
with
one
a,
picture you can paint.
Yes,
and that may be
that
true.
Could
sometimes.
Be a possibility. Yeah.
But a lot of times people use the maybe the officer had a bad day and they all that, and then if, we went back and look at that officer's record. Maybe he had none of those things, and he's just being a jerk.
Is that a bad donut?
Well, stop making cop and donut jokes. Anyway. The video is out there.
Yeah.
So you can see it. What time is it? I don't have the clock in front of me. Junior took the clock. Did he take the clock?
No.
What a jerk, man.
No.
Oh, it's 7:31.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll do that. We got plenty of good stuff in the corner at 9:15
today. Oh, yeah.
You can't not want to be missing that at all times. Joe Perry, the guitarist for Aerosmith, is 74.
And they're done?
Yeah, they had to retire because Steven Tyler took some girl across state lines or something.
Oh, okay.
Or maybe he had vocal damage. That's what I'm thinking of.
Okay.
Amy Irving, 71, the actor from Traffic and Yentl. Chris Columbus, 66, Home Alone, Mrs. Doubtfire.
Oh, okay,
the first two Harry Potter films.
Okay.
Colin Firth, 64, from The King's Speech, among other things. Big Daddy Kane, the rapper, 56. Jonathan Shaich, actor from That Thing You Do, is 55. I know that was one of your big movies.
That's a good movie.
You love that movie.
It is.
Ryan Philippe, actor from Cruel Intentions and Crash, is 50.
Philippi.
Ryan Philippine.
Philippi.
The bassist for My Chemical Romance, Mikey Way, is 44.
You like them, right?
I do. They have that one really good song. And then I think people overrate a lot of their other stuff. But you cannot criticize.
But happy birthday.
One of the trios of the emo scene.
No disrespect.
Biggest acts. Matthew Folliwell, the guitarist for Kings
What's
of
going
Leon.
On?
And also the
How
voice
many Folliwells
of the Mavericks.
They have?
What? There's like three in that band, and there's one on the Mavericks broadcast team. He's 40. Charlie Waters, 76.
Number 41.
Randy Johnson is 61.
The big unit.
The Jonas?
Jonas.
Ben Wallace is 50. Former
Great
Pistons
post player.
Center.
Yep.
Joey Votto, 41. And Paul Goldschmidt is 37. He's a 4X Gold Glove, 7X All-Star.
Paul in... what?
Okay. Well, happy birthday to all.
He's an Aristotle 1B. Aristotle 1B.
That's correct.
All-Star?
No. Aristotle. So Arizona, I guess, St. Louis.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
One base.
Gotcha.
He plays one base.
Okay. All right. That is Muse.
Patreon.com/SportsGreek.
It's Ed Werder. Football with Mr. Ed. Morning, Ed.
Hello, Giorgio. Is this your situation, losing Junior Miller at the last minute like this? Just kind of like a news anchor who finds out they have to do the 10 o'clock news by themselves and write twice as much and vamp a lot more often?
Yeah, and they don't have Gordo sitting next to you that says things like, throw it to me and I'll throw it back to you, right as we're going on the air.
Trying to get involved.
Like, I don't know how that helps anything,
to help you.
But that's what I'm dealing with this morning, and I'm sure we'll have a lot of interruptions. Gordo, if you have a question for Ed.
Yeah, Ed, what's happening with football these
days? Okay, there you go. He's out of chances.
First note, the bravery of Junior Miller in trying to play through this terrible laryngitis attack he's undergone.
He did try to play through it, but he was pretty rough. We're gonna try to get him better by tomorrow. Junior had to head home. He's got laryngitis really bad. He is really fighting it. But so it's just been me and Gordo, who's been taking pot shots at me all morning long. And now he's got the wireless microphone, and he's whispering softly into it. So let's bring in the great Gordo.
Hey, George, do you have me?
I got you loud and clear.
Okay, I'm live from your same location.
Yeah, but you don't have on headphones, so you didn't know if you're actually on the air.
For team coverage. I know. Yeah, we don't have headphones anymore. I just heard that
they die at fight night.
They broke at fight night. And so we can't hear ourselves anymore. All right.
Think I'll Killer's not worried about that right now?
I'll talk to this guy here.
Killer's not thinking about
doing,
that right
sir?
Now.
How you doing? I'm good. I'm good. Very good, man.
You're running away from me.
I'm not. I'm just letting you do your thing, but I'm actually right here.
No, we want to talk to you and find out what's going on in your life.
Well,
I'm well dressed.
Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. I'm actually an employee of Starship Express. So I'm the COO of the company. And
COO, Georgia. This is a big wig right here.
I know. I should have been one
That's
of those.
That's just a fancy title. Don't worry about it. Yeah. So yeah. We're looking forward to serve the community. We're here, as you know, with our grand opening. So here you can have your one-stop shop. We do a little bit more than shipping and freight and mail. We also do merchandise, printing. documents.
But if I wanted to buy lettuce, I would. This is not one-stop shop
no.
for that.
I can get you that.
Okay,
you
I have it mailed.
See,
here.
He'll find it. Yeah. He's going to make
you,
it happen.
You look like you're dressed. Do you remember the old show Miami Vice?
That's funny because one of my co-workers told me that.
Really?
I'm from Puerto Rico. I used to live in Miami, so I think.
Yeah, I was about to say, you had the Miami vibe going on.
Yeah, I hope that's a good thing.
Yeah, no, it is a good thing. You look good. At that. You're wearing like the loafers with no socks. You got the kind of the pastel looking pants. Yeah. Skinny pants.
Yeah, skinny pants. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's my daughter's who dressed me. So
yeah, you look great. Cool. I mean, look at us. Gordon looks like he's about to go to yard work.
No, I look wonderful.
I look good.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for knowing that. Yes, exactly. It's a hook on beard, but thank you. All right. Well, God bless.
Yeah, thank you for being here with us, man. Looking forward to everything. Want to come in? Come and join us. Free breakfast. Free
coffee. Those tacos are great.
Yep.
Yeah, they are.
Thank you for having us.
Okay. Thank
Gordon's
you.
Gordon's on his fifth one.
Head over here. This guy is a very important figure in ticket history right now. What's your name, sir?
Marcus.
And Marcus, what bit did you come up with?
Well, I'm a man of many bits, but you're talking about this morning, or yeah. Well, I'm a door knocker
for all time.
All time?
Yeah.
Drop your pants, Marcus.
Drop your pants, Marcus. He came up with the concept of dropping your pants.
No pants, no apologies.
Huh.
That's
okay.
My motto.
And you also,
I thought
you,
Bob came up with that. It's about time for the drop your pants campaign.
See, this is why I was slowly making my way towards the door before a wireless mic because I felt like I'm one of very few targets in here.
And what made you think
my
that?
My heart started beating when Gordo walks around like a shark, and I'm like, he's coming my way. I just like, well, no, I'm going to stick around and brave it out.
This is a good week. Listening, Marcus,
since I think '96.
And how many times have you emailed me under the moniker Doorknob Sock?
Once. I change it up from time to time. One of them's Magic Marcus. That, you know, I've been trying for the past 3 years, I think, to...
Could you tell that story again?
See, this is what I have to work with every day, Marcus.
That's why I was going toward the door, but... No, I've been trying for 3 years now to get on the air from the cockpit of a helicopter.
Or the pit of, yeah. You're a,
you
you're
fly
a
helicopter
guy.
The pit of cocks, if you will.
Okay.
Especially, you know.
Why do they call it the cockpit?
I guess because of me.
Okay.
I don't know.
He comes up with names to things like the Hot Fried Georgie, player of the game.
Well,
Hot Fries.
You know, I tried to call in.
I was trying to lead him to, but he would never get there. You came up with the Hot Fried Georgie, player of the game.
That was me. Yeah.
That's great. Do you remember why?
No.
Why did you associate me with hot fries? I don't think I've ever had hot fries in my life.
No. Well, I made that up, like just now.
Oh. I thought he was a guy who came up
with
it.
Oh, I thought he was, too.
Yeah.
No, really.
We have zero chemistry with him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this is a good week. You're a Longhorn fan.
I am, a Longhorn fan. Like we're,
That's a good conversation too. All right, because tell me about some of these tattoos, man. You got a lot of tattoos. What kind of life have you led?
Well, I mentioned, I'm actually a agricultural helicopter pilot. Mm-hmm. So
same.
You spray stuff.
When Giorgio brought up his,
all around,
slinging about. Mm-hmm. Now, I wanted to call in. Y'all don't take calls anymore. Fantastic Friday Fan.
We try, but Gordon never gets to him.
Yeah, people are finding out now why we don't talk to listeners a whole bunch.
Especially when George is talking about his sister. You know, I work with farmers all the time. I love working with farmers.
Oh, yeah? Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. She's but from Iowa, right?
Yeah.
Or mm-hmm. Yeah. I do most of my work in Wisconsin and Illinois.
Oh, wow.
With corn. That's
a lot of cornfields up there.
Look at this. He has a huge tattoo of farmers. 2 years of corn on the back of his forearm.
Well,
that's the most ill-advised tattoo I've ever seen in my life. And no offense.
He's in the corn business. He keeps corn alive.
How much did that cost you to get the corn?
I don't remember. If it's,
a lot of drinking problems there.
Yeah. Same here. If it,
you got a mermaid on this arm?
Yeah, that's actually my wife in mermaid form.
She's still with us, though, right?
She even got her tattoo on her arm there.
Huh. She's still alive?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Calm down. What's this tattoo on your knuckles? You got?
That's a nautical thing. Hold fast.
Were you in the Navy?
I was in the Navy yet.
Okay.
Thank you for your
service. Thank you for your service.
How you doing, sir?
What's up, Gordo? Hey, Billy Joe Coffee.
Hey, it's Billy Joe Coffee.
Well, there you have it.
I think he used to play for the Cowboys. Yeah. Oh, is that right? He's named for Billy Joe Dupree.
Helicopter talk all the time. Farm talk.
Yeah, thanks. I'm going to go talk to this guy over here. Find out what's happening with
thanks,
him.
Thanks, Marcus.
We got to get hey, thank man. You for your
how
service,
you doing?
Marcus.
It's Billy Joe.
Billy Joe, what's happening?
Gordo, what's up, man? You're my wife's favorite muser, man.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
really?
Right.
How long have you been married?
Gordon.
Ooh, man, why do you want to do it? 17 years.
17 yeah. years.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm a rookie.
Any kids?
Yes, 15 and 12. So you know how that is. Uh-huh. That's why I'm running late now.
Oh, really? You
miss
just drop the kids off?
Miss school bus. And it's like, we don't know where we're going, Dad.
Need
like,
a ride, Dad.
Like, yeah, we need a ride, Dad. Well, okay, which way are we going? I don't know. I just get on the bus, right? Yeah.
How long you been listening?
Man, since, let's see. Ooh, wow, let's see. Since you guys were at your old station, are you still with Cumulus?
Yeah.
Okay, so probably 99?
Uh-huh.
Right, hey, that's a long time.
Back to the 90s.
Yeah, okay, Billy
90s,
Joe.
Man.
And you were named for Billy Joe Dupree?
Yes, I was, right?
Okay.
My mom named me after that dude back when the Cowboys, you know.
We're good.
Yeah. But I think, like, if you look at it, if you're a Cowboy fan, we go through these 25-year cycles. So
it's, apparently.
Time is up, right? Time is up. It's about this 25, 30-year cycle. It's time for us to, you know, bring it back, man. But no, man, that's what she named after. So whatever coffee you guys are drinking, we supply that. I have a coffee shop
that's
right
great.
In the corner.
Yeah.
Actually, we do the roasting also. So, yeah, man, I'm a jack of all trades, man.
You do all right. Have you always been in coffee?
No, my previous background was purchasing, aircraft manufacturing, right? And I had a
we just talked to a helicopter pilot.
Where
he gets corn tattoos.
He sprays
right
corn.
Here, oh, wow, small world. Yeah, right here over at the Grand Prairie Airport. And that's what one of my buddies said, oh, man, you need to listen to the ticket. I'm like, whatever. You know, you with those military guys, they're up like 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
So then I started having to wake up then and start listening to you guys since then, man, and listening to Jerry and you know, Michael Irvin. School is closed, you know? So, man, I go way back, man. I
meet your wife.
How did I meet my wife? Are you serious, man? Online, bro.
Yeah.
Online, when it was cool to get catfished. It's not cool to get catfished now, right?
Man, we needed the Billy Joe show of the week.
Yeah, man. No, man.
So
met
were you, worried, you met her online.
Yeah, no.
Were you worried the first time you met her in person that she wasn't going to look like she had led you?
No, that's what I'm saying. It was cool then, right? You could, you know, you can meet people online. It was, you know, and it was fair game, right? You go in and meet them like, oh, okay, great. And then you know, a year later, we were married, man. But like I said, then about 6 months later, everybody started getting catfished. I'm like, whoo. I got
just in
the game,
time,
got
yeah.
in and out. I retired. Came off the bench, got retired at the same play.
Well, man, good. I so, love yeah, Billy
I'm
Joe.
I'm your wife's favorite, right?
Yes.
Who's your favorite?
Oh, me. No doubt. We have great
Giorgio?
Chemistry.
Yeah, it's Giorgio, man.
Yeah.
But I like Corby, too, man. Because, see, I'm an evening guy, too, though.
Okay,
so
that's great.
To those guys. And then you guys had a little mix-up, what, about 6-7 months ago?
Yeah, when we do wife swapping.
Yeah, well, yes. And then.
You ever done that?
Nah, man. Where's Norm at, man? Is he just hanging out, man?
He's retired now.
Yeah,
retired.
Part time job. Tell him to come over. I need a barista.
Imagine Norm as a barista.
Golly.
Well, that's Norm.
Oh, that's a pretty good Norm. That's a good Norm.
I go way back, man. With you guys, man. No, man. So are you still doing movie reviews?
Yeah, no, I haven't done those in a while.
We got to go, too. We got to go, Billy Joe. We're running
anyway,
late. Cat's
going to
get mad at us.
Let me get on the mic, man.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you bet. We'll say thanks for the coffee. See you, Marcus.
Oh, he's all disappointed in his appearance here.
Doorknob sock. Okay. 8:51 on the ticket. We have a special treat next in Musical Musers.
Who's it going to be today?
Well, it is my turn. We got to get right into it because we are running late. And first, I would like to thank Jonathan Tyler for having our little band, the Bird Dogs, out to open for him at Sundown at Granada last Friday. Crank this up. Jonathan was with the Northern Lights back together on stage for the first time in 8 years, and we opened for him. And he put on such an amazing show. Rock and roll is alive and well because of people like Jonathan Tyler. And that was terrific. Met a lot of nice P1s out there at Sundown in Granada on Friday. That was fun. Saturday, we played in Denton at Dog Days at Quakertown Park, where they turned the pools over to the dogs. We had over 4,900 people in this area, and dogs were swimming, and they had dogs up for adoption. It did make me think of you, Gordo. Are you still thinking about maybe getting a dog? Puppy.
Eh.
You're just up and down on the idea.
Eh.
Thought you told me you were thinking about getting a bird dog.
No, I'd love to get a bird dog at some point.
Okay.
But I meant like not Steve Porcari or something like that.
Okay. And you saw the email and passed it on to me. Met a lot of nice people, including Jordan, who emailed
yesterday.
That was
very nice of me to pass on that email.
It was nice of you. She couldn't find my email, but it was really nice of her. Said a lot of nice things. So thank you, Jordan. And thanks to the owners of a golden retriever named Jerry, who I met. And the woman was really nice. She came up and said, yes, he's a golden retriever, a big, big believer.
Okay. And, all right. First of all, a golden retriever had a name of Jerry?
Yeah. And I don't know if it was for Jerry Jones or what, but, yeah, I thought that was a funny
Spot.
Dog name, too.
He's a weird dog.
And he was a big, big believer. Okay. Here's an act coming to town this week. They're actually playing the Granada. Recently discovered them. They're out of Auburn, Alabama. They're called the Stews. Tell me what you think of these dudes.
Okay. Out.
Come on.
Okay. There was just standing around, waiting for a change. Just didn't know what the next step needs to be. I can't see it coming. Sometimes you gotta take that leap of faith. Off into the dark. I'll find the next time. Just to push and shove until you fall apart. Oh, it's hard to stand here when it could all.
So I saw these guys were playing at Granada.
Yeah, this dude has a good voice. I like his voice. I like that little smooth bass line.
Yeah, they're really good musicians because I went down and listened to this rabbit hole of, I don't know, 20 of their songs last week and really like them. I've been listening to them ever since. They play the Granada this Friday. Yeah, that's Friday the 13th. You know that was coming up?
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, that is this Friday. Okay, I wanted to find out how big this artist is right now. She came out with her first album, first full album, in 2023. And it's done this slow creep to where songs on that record that she put out in 2023 were up in Spotify as much as 500% in the months of April and May.
Of this year.
Of this year. And the reason I think they went up was because she came out with this single. This is called Good Luck, Babe, and it made it to number 6. Tell me what you think of this artist, and see if you can name this artist. Very 80s.
Very 80s.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's cool.
Name this artist. Can anyone?
Yeah, this
on the morning
is Chapel
show?
Roan. She's
very
big.
Good.
She's big.
Very good.
Yeah, she is blown up.
I thought Gordo may have known her. I didn't know if anyone else would. Yeah, she's big, and I just discovered her a couple of months ago, I guess, when a lot of America did, when this single came out, and then it made
like the way she dresses. She wears some wild outfits.
She's a woman, but she dresses as a drag queen. Is one of her bits. And yeah, she's great. I think she's incredible. We're going to ACL, and she's blown up to the point where they've moved her set from Saturday to Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that's the big time to play. And yeah, just in the last 3 or 4 months, she has really skyrocketed, and it's made people go back and listen to songs that were on that The Rise and Fall of a Midwest Princess. Like this song, which is a real earworm. It's played around my house a lot, this next song here.
That move also made a lot of ticket holders mad.
Yeah, because they specifically bought for Chapel Roan on Saturday.
Huh.
Just give it a second.
You wanted me to stay, but I can't ignore the crazy visions of me in LA. special place where boys and girls can all be queens every single day. I'm having wicked dreams of leaving Tennessee. If Santa Monica, I swear it's calling me, will make my mama proud. It's gonna cause a scene. She sees her baby girl, I know she's gonna scream. God, what have you done? You're a pink pony girl, and you dance at the club. Oh, mama, I'm just having fun.
This be a great Ribby song.
Yeah. This is great.
Yeah,
I mean, the dynamics of this song are cool.
Yeah.
That whole break just then was cool with just the synth playing.
Yeah.
If Katy Perry had been around in the 80s, this is kind of, I think, what she would have sounded like.
Yeah, this is very similar to that sound.
Influenced by her, I do believe, and certainly influenced by the sound of the 80s.
Love the title of her album, The Rise and Fall of a Midwest Princess.
Yeah. Yeah, that's where she grew up in Missouri.
Yeah, great.
Yeah, she's interesting. I've seen a couple of live performances, not in person, but just like I saw her performance at Coachella.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that she really blew up after that. She looks incredible live. All-girl band that's really good, and she is a awesome performer. But yeah, I had not heard of her until, I guess, I don't know, this past June or so.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's a lot of people who really hadn't heard much about her until... that first song came out as a single, Good Luck Babe, in April of this year. But there you go.
She was influenced by Kate Bush is one of her big...
Yeah. And that first song certainly sounded...
Beating of a song.
I think all of her stuff's better than Kate Bush. But there you go. A little late to the party, but thought we'd give her some time here on the Morning Musers, Chapel Roan. Up next, Gordo's Corner.
In Gordo's Corner, we're going to introduce you to Chapel Roan.
I already did that.
Oh, you did?
Yep.
Okay, the happiest state in the world. Next. Thank you, Giorgio. Okay, you just asked me a question. And I have some audio support for this. So let's see. My computer runs so slow, I got to get a new one. Yeah. It's struggling. It's struggling. Hold on. I got to get past this and hit skip, and then it's like a whole deal.
That wasn't the question.
So you asked me if James Earl Jones sang this.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch.
Does that sound like him?
You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel.
Yeah, it does sound like him. I can tell why you would think that. But no, that was...
Chapel Roan?
No.
Oh.
No. Thurl Ravenscroft.
Okay, it is a weird name.
I told you it was weird.
Yeah.
He's the same dude who did the voice of Tony the Tiger.
They're great.
And I think he also did, like, some other cartoon voices back in the day, probably for Hanna-Barbera. Who knows? So, yeah, that's not James Earl Jones.
Frosted Flakes are great.
I swear, when I was a kid, we used to eat Frosted Flakes and still ladle sugar on top of that. And I remember thinking that one of the best things in the world was finishing the bowl of cereal and then scooping up and eating the mound of sugar that was up under the surface of the milk.
Did you? What were we thinking?
Did you always drink the milk thing at the end of cereal?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. And there may be a few pieces of cereal that were floating around, but that was the best thing to do. Yeah, it was
and then
sugar milk.
When I would eat, I remember my first lesson in delayed gratification.
Ladle more sugar on
was Lucky Charms. I would eat all of the cereal part and then save the marshmallows for last. They'd be all nice and bloated with lactation.
Yeah.
And then you'd just spoon
straight
marshmallows into your mouth, and it was glorious.
Are you ready for a really hot take?
Sure. This is about the Longhorns?
Much like much like Notre Dame football, I think Lucky Charms and their little goofy little Irishmen were way overrated.
Dude, hot crazy
sports. Okay, marshmallow nice. Has no place in cereal.
Oh gosh,
yeah,
you're talking insanity right
and
now.
Way too much food Twitter. Coloring in it.
No, food coloring's great.
Give me, you know, if we're just talking sugar cereals, give me any sort of Captain Crunch, King Vitamin.
Captain Crunch is great.
Fruity Pebbles,
Cinnamon Toast Crunch,
Cinnamon Toast Crunch. Yeah, I always if I went to a friend's house and they said, "Hey, look, we got Lucky Charms," I was like,
"Really?
I may just have toast."
I even think they came out with a version of Lucky Charms that had like double the marshmallows in it. It was like the double stuffed of Lucky Charms.
Marshmallows have their place. I just don't think it's in cereal.
Marshmallows have their place.
Golden Grahams is a very underrated sweet cereal, too.
I liked Golden Grahams,
Golden Grahams, okay, yeah.
Okay, but when I was a kid, there was a old person cereal that I loved and still love it.
Raisin Bran?
No, not Raisin Bran.
Quaker Oats?
No, stop guessing.
Grape Nuts?
I'm going to tell you if you stop guessing.
Hot Dog?
But as long as you guess, I'm not
okay,
going to
I
tell
won't
you.
Guess anymore.
It's called Cracklin' Oat Bran.
Yeah. I
and
remember
I
that.
I loved it.
I did too.
As a kid.
Yeah.
Now, it would absolutely take 80 grit sandpaper to the roof of your mouth.
Bingo. It would tear up your mouth, yes. Just like Captain Crunch would.
Yeah. Destroy your mouth.
Yeah.
So anytime Crackle you talk to someone for the rest of the day, you'd open your mouth and it'd look like the shark from Jaws. I mean, it's just skin hanging down everywhere.
I wonder if they still have that. I haven't seen that in
years. Sure, they do. Yeah.
Really?
I'm not positive, but as
but when's
a few
the last
years
time you had
ago,
Cracklin' Oat Bran?
There was a few years ago. I got the hankering and went to the store and got me some Cracklin' Oat Bran. Love it.
My mom wouldn't buy sugar cereals unless I really sweet talked her, and it was usually Captain Vitamin or Captain Crunch.
What is Captain Vitamin?
I'm sorry. Yeah, no, King Vitamin and Captain Crunch.
What's King Vitamin?
You never ate breakfast like a king?
No. That sounds like a knockoff.
I think it was around before Captain Crunch.
But it was Captain Crunch.
It was
adjacent.
A lot like it. Yeah, it was very, very much like it.
Yeah, that was that whole Post and Kellogg would have similar type of cereals. They were always counter-programming each other.
Yeah. And we just don't seem to be pushing the cereals like we used to.
You know what's crazy is I think Cheerios is still way up there.
I think it's the top-selling cereal still.
Was that still
we did
a,
that a couple of years ago?
Was it a deal when your boys were young to where you'd dump a thing of Cheerios on a kid's tray?
Yep. Yeah.
And watch them for forever, try to use their little fingers to pick them up and eat them.
To this day, we still keep say I'm scarfing on these Cheerios because that's what our oldest said when he was two.
He said he was scarfing on those Cheerios?
We thought it was the funniest thing we'd ever heard.
But like Cheerio technology, has that gotten high too? Because we used to just have Cheerios and then Honey Nut Cheerios.
Honey Nut, we got chocolate, we got, they've gone in some different directions. But I still think it's a quality cereal though, just
have they
regular
started
old
the
Cheerios.
Unstable cross-branding of like having Doritos Cheerios and...
I'm sure they will.
Pizza Supreme Cheerios.
They probably will.
I'm just amazed at how much crossbreeding
Oat
we do.
You're the
loved
first
it.
Person.
I know it.
I can't believe after all these years
we've
never
outlier.
Talked about
I was an
Cracklin'
outlier.
Oat Bran.
I'm with you, Gordon. Then, Cracklin' Oat Bran is greatness.
It was great. Okay. And then in my family, it seems like we split along lines of my brother. He was big into Frankenberry. He always ate Frankenberry.
Man, I hated that whole campaign.
Really?
Count Chocula,
I loved it. I was the Count Chocula guy.
Before
I was Cracklin' Oat Bran, I was Count Chocula. Love Count Chocula. Well, once again, Giorgio, it's the same formula as the Lucky Charms, which
right.
is you have the cereal bits, and then you have marshmallows.
That's why I didn't like it.
Oh, it's so good.
I'm telling you, marshmallows.
I just
not
want
a
bowl
a
of marshmallows every day for breakfast.
Well, you had that this morning. You had marshmallow Rice Krispie treats.
Floating in milk. And then my younger sister, it seemed like she liked the Boo-berry.
Boo-berry.
Yeah, all the characters. I'm with you on the characterizations.
They
didn't
make me want to eat cereal.
Like Frankenberry, he was kind of a nervous gay Frankenstein, wasn't he? You
yes.
know what I'm talking about?
And his brother, Boo-berry, he was
gay
also.
Yeah.
I mean, no offense.
It's, no, it's I a, mean, they were happy.
It was an early celebration.
Yeah.
And then Count Chocula may have been, too. I think Count Chocula was kind of...
He was just creepy.
He was pansexual.
I just thought he was creepy.
Really?
Yeah, it didn't make me want to eat cereal.
But I thought the cereals were great. And I want to say that there was another monster cereal in that family. Like, there were the three brothers, Boo and Count Chocula, who was a count. Only one of them's a count.
Sugar Bear?
What?
You remember Sugar Bear? What was this cereal?
Sugar Bear. Wasn't it called Sugar
Bear? Was it Sugar Bear? Is that the name of the cereal? He had a sweater on. He was a real
remember.
Cool
that's
bear.
Not the,
hey, man, what's some Sugar Bear?
That's not the little one that...
Wasn't that cereal called
it's like
Sugar
a cereal
Snaps?
That looked like a little tiny...
Vaginas?
You know what I'm talking about?
Sorry, everybody here.
You know, but you know what I'm talking about. What is it called? No, it wasn't Raisin Nuts. Snacks
the
look
V.
Like, boy, everyone has opinions yeah. on which cereals look like V's.
Oh, Smacks?
Yes, yeah, Sugar Smacks.
Sugar Smacks. That yeah. was the frog.
Boy, he nailed it.
He digs
knew exactly
them.
Which
Diggle.
One. Yeah. Did you ever think a frog would be hawking
vagina-shaped
no. cereal? Did I know I was going to ask that this morning when I woke up?
You, maybe.
I planned the whole show to get us to
you
this
know
point.
What? I'm going to ask this question.
Okay. All right. All we right. need to talk about the happiest state after you got me distracted.
Sorry.
You got me distracted giving the P1s the information that they deserve, but that the government doesn't want them to know about. What was I going to talk about? Oh,
happiest
the happy state.
State.
Happy okay.
State.
They did this study. Wallet Hub did it.
Okay.
That's a place where you can go and buy a wallet online. How often do you replace your wallet? I've had two my
had
entire
the same
adult
one
life.
For 20 years. Or 15. Listen.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in my adult life, I've had two wallets. Both of them being given to me by women. And the second one gave it to me to replace it because she was tired of me carrying one from the first one.
She's tired of your Velcro wallet.
Yeah. Like, girl gave you this in the 80s. Anyway.
Okay.
So
Wallet the, Hub says.
The happiest state in America. Would you like to guess what it is?
Is it in the Northeast?
No.
Okay.
Washington.
Is it in the Northwest?
No.
Dang. Is it in the Southwest?
No.
Midwest.
I'll tell you this, it's not contiguous with other states.
Hawaii
is number one.
I could see that. How could you not be happy there?
They did this based on, you know, a bunch of stuff. 30 different metrics, unemployment rates, people reporting traumatic childhood events, all kinds of stuff, right?
Okay.
Hawaii was number one, Maryland second, then New Jersey. Then Utah. At fifth was Delaware, and number six was your home state of Minnesota.
Yeah, that makes sense. I was going to go kind of the Minnesota-Wisconsin way next. Utah is an underrated state. You ever spent time in Utah? There's some really beautiful spots in Utah.
Yeah, P1
Wide
Nick
open
is
spaces.
Always talking up Utah.
Yeah, it's really pretty.
He's always taking me aside. Hey, man.
I could be happy in Utah.
Put that on a shirt. Six is Minnesota, your home state.
Yeah, people are
seven
there. Nice.
Is Connecticut.
Yeah,
eight Idaho, nine Nebraska, and 10 Massachusetts.
Idaho's underrated too. There's a lot of really pretty areas in Idaho.
Okay, so then you get to the least happy states. By the way, since we're doing home states, your home state of Minnesota, sixth, ranked the highest of the three Muser home states.
I don't know if that's my home state. I wasn't born there.
Is.
I spent the least amount of time there of anywhere I've ever lived.
You were born in Minnesota, and you only moved here 5 years ago.
Born in San Antonio.
My home state of Texas is 38th.
Oh, that's depressing.
That is.
We're not even top 20?
That's pretty low. Yeah, we're not even in the top 50th percent of happy states. Then you move on down to I was very happy about this ranking, though, because when you get to juniors, home state of Oklahoma, 43rd on the list.
Oh, no.
Of happiest states. Ranking right above it, one ahead of it, at 42, Mississippi.
Mississippi?
Yeah. What do you think is the bottom five least happy states?
Is it in the southeast, I guess?
Always the same.
Is it West Virginia?
West Virginia is 48th. Don't call it Virginia. That makes you sound like such a banjo-toting hillbilly.
West Virginia. Maybe don't tell me Tennessee's on there.
Tennessee is 47th.
Wow.
So, yeah, bottom five.
Well, people I've known in Tennessee have been really happy. Don't tell me Georgia's on there.
No, Georgia is actually, looks like it's a little bit higher on the list.
What about Kentucky?
Wait a second.
Let's go to
Georgia's
Florida.
20th on the list. That's pretty high. What'd you say?
Kentucky.
Kentucky is not in the bottom five.
Bottom.
Illinois? No, that's your other home state. No, the bottom five is, well, I'll do bottom six. Alaska's 45th. Mm-hmm. Then New Mexico's 46th. Then 47, Tennessee. 48, West Virginia. 49.
Good morning to you.
Oh, Arkansas.
Uh-huh. And 50th, Louisiana. Poor Louisiana.
People I know from Louisiana are happy.
I know. Javier was from Louisiana.
Yeah.
He seemed happy.
He was really happy.
He was really happy that Elizabeth Taylor had the booty.
Bruce Springsteen.
She had the whole package.
Had the whole package.
All right. We got to get going.
I had a dream that happened to me last night, and it felt really weird. So I woke up like at 3:30 in the morning thinking that there was someone at my door on my porch. And I was freaking out until I realized that I was, you know, that it wasn't real. But I was like sweating, like crazy. Really close to grabbing
A nine?
A protection weapon.
My dream is just way better than yours.
Just to make sure. But
I'm going to grab a protection weapon.
And I couldn't fall back asleep until like 30 minutes later.
I will shoot you with my protection weapon.
Well.
Did you get out of bed?
I did, yeah.
Did you get
I don't think Donnie owns a gun.
Oh, come on. He does.
Well, what does that mean?
You've told me that you do.
What does that mean? Yeah, what does that mean?
Boy, this is a throwback to your old coach.
Yeah, my goodness. Of course he does.
He
turns it sideways when he holds it.
Just call me Mike Zimmer.
Hey, look at there. Turn it sideways there. Hey, right.
Hey, been shooting people with your Glock. Hey, Danny.
Hey.
Yeah, how many nines? I think you got nine nines. All right. Yeah.
Danny loves violence.
Nine? All right.
He loves shooting people.
What millimeter is Donnie's gun, Norm?
Nine.
Yeah, there's Norm again.
Man, we have many protection weapons around the house. Strategically placed.
Outside of a gun, what else? Like a bat? A hatchet?
That sounds like a Norm phrase.
Crossbow.
If you're in need of a protection weapon.
There's so many different ones that you can have around the house.
I know.
Where are you getting what else?
So you have a baseball bat and like a scuba knife and throwing stars and stuff like that.
Seven iron, some nunchucks.
Where are you getting your protection weapons? It's a simple question.
So it just doesn't matter where you are in my home. I could grab something and take you out while I'm nude.
Man, that's a good idea.
We used to have a guy who worked here claimed you could roll up a magazine and use that as a weapon. He claimed he could kill a man with a rolled up magazine.
Kill him. Yes,
no, I bet you could.
You could definitely distract him.
If you hit him in the larynx, you could probably crush his trachea.
No, you can't. With a magazine?
I bet you could.
No, you can't.
Roll one up. It is amazing. It's like all of a sudden you got a little wooden bat. At the end of it.
Yes, you got
to jab.
Yes, it's the tensile strength of the end-to-end.
I think, seriously, like if you get somebody in the throat and crush their trachea, they can't breathe.
You cannot do that with a magazine.
I think you could roll one up.
Pretty sure
check
you
it
can,
out.
Man.
No.
Oh, Donnie rolls one up all the time, pal.
We'll end on that high. That's amazing. That's a really funny joke, and that'll
Great.
Do it for today.
I don't know what you've heard about Jeep,
buddies with the sweet spot 1 and 3. He loves rainbows, sunsets, and puppies. He's the afternoon J-U-B. I don't know what you've heard about G, but he's with the sweet spot 1 to 3. He treats Oxnard women respectfully. He's the afternoon J-U-B.
Oh, it's a new open.
It's 2:38. This is the sweet spot. And how about that? And how about one George Dunham of the Morning Musers, the Texas Radio Hall of Famer, joining us as he does every single Tuesday. Hi, Jeb.
Hey, fellas. I'm on time this week. How about that?
How's your back doing after having to carry Gordon all morning with Craig dealing with laryngitis?
It's killing me.
Man.
Yeah.
Is there anyone else in radio that tries to sabotage his own show?
We work with one guy known as
Ham. Yeah. Okay.
I think there's one person per show that, because I've been that person before.
Yeah.
Now I've
matured. We've got to lead all other radio stations in that, in the country.
Probably so. It's amazing we're as successful as we are, but I'm glad you're here. Incredible. I'm glad you're on time. And I think, Monto, didn't you have a topic you wanted to start off with Ja today?
Yeah, I heard McLaren bring this up earlier in his show. It was a big monumental moment in he and his son's life because yesterday, for the first time ever, his son beat him in one-on-one basketball.
Yeah, I heard that. That was a great segment.
It was. It was really cool to hear that. I'm wondering if you had a moment like that with your kids or with your dad, because it is very memorable. Whenever
we lose hot dog?
No, we got you.
You're full hot dog.
You're on your Dodger dog.
No, y'all are on.
I don't think he can hear us.
Hold on. No.
Okay, I got you now.
You got us? Okay. We had you the whole time.
Yeah, you were fine.
I was curious to see how that was going to go.
You heard me dad cuss?
Yeah. Oh, drat.
Speaking of that, before we get to the beating your kid at basketball thing, I heard George dad cuss in person while watching the Cowboy game. And what did you say, George, out loud?
Fruit basket.
You said fruit.
Oh, fruit.
Not even fruit basket, just fruit.
Yeah, just fruit.
That has been floating in my head for the past 2 days.
Is that a go-to of George's
fruit?
You were
pointing at someone.
Yeah, that one.
Are you calling someone that?
I'm trying to cut down on my bad words.
It's Michael Sam.
Yeah. That's why we changed the open. We didn't want you to have some potty mouth with us.
Yeah, you don't want that. No, I thought it was a really good topic because I remember distinctly two times my two older sons, I used to play 1-on-2 with them in basketball on the driveway. And it was one of those deals, you know, when they were little, you know, I may have let them win when they were, you know, one was 10 and one was 6. Mm-hmm. But then they got older and the game started getting really competitive. And I remember distinctly if they didn't beat me for a while. And once they got to where it was close where they could beat me, there were several times when I hit the winning bucket and ran off the driveway into the house.
Doing total, the total walk off.
You guys figure out dinner.
You had your hands still in the air.
And it really ticked them off. It was terrible parenting on my part.
You wouldn't kiss their mom in front of them.
And then my oldest who plays golf, I mean, my oldest who got really good, he's still a scratch player. And now he just, you know, it's once in a blue moon when I can beat him on the golf course. But he was about 14 or so, and he was getting better. And he, you know, and we were playing this course in Denison that's not even there anymore. It's it was a Muni, and we were playing with some family members. And next thing I know, I look on like 16 or 17, he'd made like 2 birdies in a row. And he was in position to beat me if I bogeyed the last hole and he had a birdie putt. And so here I am like 100 feet away from the hole and I'm over the ball thinking, okay, this is a real dad moment for you. How are you going to react when he beats you?
Ooh, mind games.
And so I'm thinking about it. And then I thought, wait a minute, what if this goes in? And I made about a 100-foot putt.
Oh.
And again, I ran around the green like Hale Irwin after he won the U.S. Open.
You like that?
Just doing the Happy Gilmore.
You like that?
Riding a bull.
Oh, man. It was terrible. And I think back at that, and we laugh about it now. But then I remember, you know, like my dad and I used to play golf. And when I beat him for the first time, I remember it was really satisfying, but there was something really sad about it, too. You know, it's like, you know, my old man's losing his fastball. And now, you know, they just trounce on me now, whatever it is, whatever the sport. And thankfully, they're sweet about it. You know, they don't, they handle it better. I mean, I was very much like Dion. when I won, I had some wild celebrations. But yeah, it's a really good topic because, you know, at what age do you start getting competitive with your kids, you know, and not just letting them have a easy path to the basket? There were some very NBA-like fouls sometimes, you know, and that was another thing that would, you know, get tense. And I would have to say, you know, I'm sorry. I'm just, you know, trying to be competitive here. And, yeah, that's a really good topic because it's right about that age, too, that Matt's kid is, you know, like 14 or so. That's when you can start taking, you know, the old man in a couple of different sports.
And I think as the dad, you would feel more proud, like, once the kid can finally beat you at basketball or golf or something. Like, it'd probably suck at first.
Yeah.
But when he does win, you're like, yeah, he got those genetics from me. This kid's an athlete.
Yeah, and there is that moment when you're on the dad side of it. Yeah, you're thinking, okay, all right, he's starting to get this thing, and there is a definite pride moment. But then, yeah, we're wired so in such a weird way that there's part of you too that feels like you're dying inside. You know, like, God, I can't even beat a 14-year-old.
You're so washed.
Of course, I was the dad on the block too that thought nothing of when we. And I was always the dad that would play pickup baseball games when the kids were little, and I thought nothing of jacking a 3-run homer and slow trotting around the bases.
Bat flip.
And, yeah, and rejecting shots from a little 7-year-old driving the lane. You know.
It's fun
there.
Yeah.
It is fun just to kind of see the failed smile look on their face, you know, and the ball gets swatted and goes over the fence and hey, sorry, you want to go get that?
Oh,
think about it next time you try to lay it up.
Yeah, that's the only thing about being a girl dad that I sort of regret, not having a son. Because
you can still kick their ass in basketball.
There's no question.
Take them out in the driveway and show them a few things.
I'll be way older than them and still be able to dominate them because they got their mom's genes on that front. But we are still super competitive with them. Like Mario Kart, wife and I we don't take it easy on them at all. Just about any
select your player.
any board game we play, we are playing to win. So
yeah.
At least we're trying to like give them some competitive genes.
It builds
on that
character.
Front. Yeah, take your L,
boy.
Figure it out.
And isn't Mario Kart maybe one of the greatest all time games?
There's no question about it.
Best multiplayer game ever.
GoldenEye, but yeah, maybe.
Yeah,
so.
you've got a point. You got a point. Mario.
Yeah,
Kart's...
but GoldenEye doesn't have Yoshi.
That's true. Or Waluigi.
But imagine if it did.
GoldenEye has Odd Job.
That's true. They do have Odd Job, Ham.
Yoshi's my go-to, George, on Mario Kart. Yoshi's
I love
he's
Yoshi.
The goat. He's the goat.
I like, when it's time to select your player.
I like Tanuki Mario.
Speaking of dad cussing, do you remember the first time you've heard your kids cuss?
Yeah. Unfortunately, with my middle one, who's now a coach, speaking as we have so many times of the Sandlot, he heard Benny say the S word, and I think he watched it when he was like 3. And here's some more bad parenting for you. My wife did wash his mouth out with
soap.
Oh yeah.
That's the word.
It works.
We
terrible.
Need to bring that back.
Yeah, it's awful.
Because he
so
said he, and he said he was really just brazen about it. She said, "We don't say that word." And he said, "I don't care." No, you
yes.
will care. You won't say that word. And he dropped it right on her again.
The first,
I don't give a S.
Corby kids.
The first one I remember saying was "son of a bitch" because it was in Back to the Future, and it was in like kindergarten or something, and the teacher's like, oh, we're going to do, you know, whatever assignment today. And all the kids are like, oh, oh. And I go, son of a bitch. And then I got a stern talking to.
As you
I
should.
Didn't know it was a bad word. I think I just saw it in a movie. I heard Marty McFly say it.
I think I burned him in my mom.
I do I know of a... Of a,
I'm not going to drink out of this sippy cup again.
Sorry, Justin, what did you say?
Get canceled.
Is that anyone's first man. Cuss word? Like, as a three-year-old, they say that one?
I hope not.
Well, yeah, because I know of a three-year-old who likes to listen to the Ticket Mouse.
Mm. Oh, no.
And
you know a three-year-old?
Yeah.
Oh, family member?
Yeah.
Okay.
Family member.
Not a friend.
And,
hey, he's like, I just got friends with better three-year-olds.
Yeah. I hang out with,
you know, Caden. He's super chill.
I got some nursery school friends.
He's
we
in
just
my
hang
fantasy
out.
League.
Watch games and stuff. Yeah. They're in my fantasy league. he listens to the Ticket Mouse, and he heard, I don't know, something, you know, the word stupid, which you shouldn't, you know, that's not a nice word.
Right.
And, he then proceeded to say, yeah, the Ticket Mouse says a lot of words like, you probably shouldn't say, and the next time I threw that bitch into a combine.
How do you not laugh?
Yeah, let's you stay away to. From that phrase when we go to preschool today.
Oh, man.
And then he's like, I'm going to draft Christian McCaffrey with my first pick.
Oh, you want McCaffrey? Okay, got you down.
You believe they scratched him last
fruit.
Night?
He didn't play last night.
Fruit basket.
Oh, fruit. Can you believe he wasn't active last night?
Oh,
have you seen Gone Fishing yet?
No, he hasn't seen it yet.
Well, I did, but we don't have time to talk about it.
It's 49, man. We'll do it next week.
Okay, next week.
All right, Joe. Drats. Fruit basket.
All right, boys.
We'll see you.
It's good talk.
It's Pudge Pudge.
See you, Ham.
Greatness. We'll talk next week where we will not talk about Gone Fishing again. All right, it's 250. Why Today Doesn't Suck is next.
Once again, the ticket presents Why Today Doesn't Suck.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
Now, here are your hosts, Sean Bass and David Mino.
Sweet spot. Special thanks to Pudge Pudge for doing some afternoon jubbing with us. And at 2:59, it's IHAM.
Thank you, Mino. Eatsy's Market and Bakery, GiveMeTheVin.com, brings you Monty Does Suck.
Thank you, Ham. We say hello to the Hardline, who is back in studio partying. We have Bob, we have Dave,
Bob.
Dave,
and we have Corby.
Corby.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hey now.
Hello.
What's up?
Hello.
Well, today.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. Hello.
Hi.
Hey, Tom.
Tuesday, September 10th, the 254th day of 2024, 112 days are left in the year. On this date in 1897... we had the first ever person to be arrested for drunk driving as a 25-year-old taxi driver named George Smith slammed his cab into a building.
George?
He pleaded guilty and was fined $25.
He's like, look, I've done this thousands of times.
Yeah.
The first time I get caught, I'm the first guy arrested.
He was going 21 in a 15.
Oh, man.
That'll get you
every time.
So was there never a thing like horseback riding while intoxicated?
No, because you know that was every day all over the country.
Unless the horse is also intoxicated.
Yeah, that's true.
The horse was your designated driver.
I bet that was part of their sports back then, was let's see if you can get the horse the drunkest, and then we race that thing.
I would watch that.
And we could put it on pay-per-view.
Probably not. Okay.
Around the campfire, see, there wasn't really.
They didn't have closed circuit.
They didn't really have pay-per-view yet.
On this day, 1945, Mike the Headless Chicken.
Rely on network distribution.
Was decapitated in, for George, Fruta, Colorado. He survived another 18 months before choking to death.
Oh, no.
Legend.
Who choked the chicken?
Ooh.
From the Northeast!
How did it feed without a head? How did it choke without a head?
What am I, a scientist over here?
You know, we're all one generation removed, almost. Maybe two for some.
From choking chicken?
Yeah, from our parents. I mean, my mom several times told me the story. She had to go outside and wring the neck of a chicken. That's one generation for me. She killed her own chicken.
Had to defeather the thing?
I guess. Yeah. I don't know, man. They were weird back then.
Can you imagine how much work tendies used to be, Ham?
Yeah, ham.
It'd be worth it.
Not even worth it.
You would just
worth it.
No.
It might make it better for him because he could kill something.
I would commit chicken genocide.
But he wouldn't have. He would have just eaten okra. He would have known what okra was and he would just eat that.
You're right, though.
You'd have had to rely on like bison tenders or something.
One to two generations
back. They call
me
Pollo Pot.
The lady of the house would
that's pretty good.
Go out back and kill tonight's dinner in the chicken coop.
Yes.
I just don't know that we're made for that.
No, we're not. We're soft.
So Mike the Headless Chicken was fed liquid food and water that was dropped directly into his esophagus.
Boost.
Yeah, they gave him chicken boost.
I think I'm going to kill my dinner tonight. I think I'm going to do it.
A chance.
I would love
to see you
try
that. Whatever I can find.
You would be vegan so quick.
A cat?
Some old
ham.
Girl?
Okay, if you were forced to, like, that was it.
Play.
You're not allowed to eat any fish and or meat the rest of your life. Don't you think, unless you kill it. Would you just say, I'm just going to not eat it then, because it's too big of a beating?
I wouldn't eat beef.
It's okay to eat fish, because they don't have any feelings.
That's right, Elaine.
Just go vegan.
I could kill a chicken if I needed.
Just go hunting. Or some venison.
It's just, you got to get up and go, get in the car.
Like a man.
You have to get in your car to go get food.
Can you eat fake meat?
Yeah.
Mark.
You have to kill the fake meat?
No.
No, it's like soy. Perfect for you, bros.
Yeah, you guys probably love that, wouldn't you?
Kill your fake meat.
I love that.
That's the best Bob bit going right now. You'd like that, wouldn't you?
On this date in 1977, Hamida Jandoubi, convicted of torture and murder, is the last person to be executed by guillotine.
Oh,
1977.
Damn.
In 77?
In the world or in the United States?
In the world.
Is there video?
Awesome.
I don't want to watch it, but
I mean, that
maybe.
Was probably like after Monday Night Football.
It's the Heidi game.
Stay tuned for the weekly guillotine.
Pablo Picasso was barely put in his grave.
That's right, yeah.
And not an a-hole line four guy.
No, definitely not.
In 1984, the first episode of the daily syndicated game show Jeopardy premiered with Alex Trebek as host.
Look at that, got him.
So's your mother, Trebek.
Dead.
He is missed. Like 40 years later.
Oh.
There's something there, though. Look into it. In 1991, rock band Nirvana released their single Smells Like Teen Spirit.
What's the Monty review?
I like it.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a good album.
Very solid.
I'm going to go out on a limb, Dave, and say Nevermind is a good album. What do you think? 787-1310. It's
quite fatty salad.
Quite a limb you're out on.
Without them, we wouldn't have foo.
Mm-hmm.
That's pre-foo.
More on them in E-News.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, no way.
Stay tuned.
Well,
breaking
foo not what
news.
You think there,
give
bud.
Did E-News back to Courtney, Dave?
Not what you think.
Look, Dave, we're not getting enough
look, dude,
foo.
Foo is bull.
You take the snake pit.
I got this today.
Step aside,
yeah,
Lane.
Wait, little
stand
fella.
Back and learn.
In 1993, The X-Files debuted on Fox. Way too scary.
Never saw an episode.
Great.
Not one episode.
Not doing it. in 2006 in a game between the Colts and Giants. We had the first ever NFL game featuring two brothers with Peyton and Eli Manning.
Are you saying
starting
Peyton or Peyton?
Came out of the same womb.
Peyton Manning?
Peyton and Eli Manning.
Peyton.
Yeah, not Peyton.
Peyton.
He'd be the best.
I wish Eli had EA voice. I would always watch the Manning cast.
Yes.
Peyton. They're just always arguing.
Why do we keep having this guy on?
He'd be upset. Michael Jordan now? Are you kidding me?
In
2008, the Large Hadron Collider at the European Organization for Nuclear Research was powered up for the first time, successfully firing the first beams of protons through an underground ring tunnel. I just remember them doing that and them saying, look, there's like a 1% chance we're all going to get sucked into a black hole and reality is going to be gone. But we're going to do it anyway.
Here we are.
I said Halcyon, yeah.
Hadron.
My bad.
We have one P1 birthday today.
Confused sometimes.
It happens.
It happens to the best of us. Good afternoon, Monto. I'd like to wish a happy 29th birthday to a good, strong P1 out in Midland. You from Midland, right? My best friend since 8th grade and 3'11 brother in Christ, Ashton. His leaders are Corby and the great Donovan. He once entered the Dunham Zone while on a cruise in the middle of the ocean, and his shorts had to be thrown overboard.
Hell yeah.
He liked to hear what's in Norm's underwear, that from the King of Pho, Jay.
Hey, line four guy.
Yes, Norm.
Guess what I have in my underwear?
Pho?
It's nutty. It's just nutty. Yes.
In an abortion.
Peeling his underwear off.
We're docking.
Charlie Waters is 76.
Ah, Chuck.
Hot.
Happy birthday, Charlie.
He was pink, right?
Roger Waters.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Pink. Old rock and roll Monto popping up. Sorry.
Don't apologize.
Turning 61 today, current NFL photographer Randy Johnson.
Randy.
The unit.
Johnson.
Really funny to just see a big old 6'10 country guy taking photos.
Like Randy and
Panthers
Griffey are doing that.
If I...
He knows Geddy Lee.
Like if I could show my children, plural, one video that completely encompasses baseball from the 1900s, it would be the Randy Johnson bird kill.
Yeah.
He killed his own food, didn't he?
I remember seeing that video. It was probably 10 years after that happened. It was an urban legend for a while. It was like, did he actually do
this? What year
was
that?
2000, maybe?
Was it? Okay, I thought it was in the 1900s.
I think it was 2000 or 01. Okay. But it was like until YouTube came along in 06. I'm like, oh, he actually did it.
So
it's crazy.
March of 01.
There you go. There you
go. Joe Nieuwendyk, 58.
Greatness.
Conn Smythe.
Ben Wallace is 50.
Ben Wallace.
Greatness. Joey Votto, 41.
Hall of Famer should be.
Turning 75
Never
today.
Up to first base.
Bill O'Reilly.
We'll do it live.
Do it live!
Joe Perry of Aerosmith, 74.
Sparrow Smith.
Get him. Clark Johnson, 70. He was in The Wire. He
Brendan
played
Lewis.
Gus, the newspaper editor. Hey,
yo, what up, okay. Bird?
Yeah.
Season 5.
Black guy.
Also The Shield.
Yeah.
Oh, I know now I know exactly Black who dude. It is.
Turning 66 today, Chris Columbus, the director of Home Alone.
Get the day off.
Colin Firth is 64, actor in The Kingsman. Great movie. Raymond Cruz is 60. You would know him as Tuco Salamanca.
Breaking Bad.
Tight.
Yeah.
Most underrated villain in that show.
Gone too soon, I would say.
Yeah. Always doing blow off a Bowie knife. Yep.
God, he was so mean.
He was great.
So mean.
Robin Goodridge is 58, drummer of Bush.
You want your bad guys to be nicer, soy boy?
Jeez.
I love Andrew Tate, Bob. It's just awesome.
Unbelievable.
Big Daddy Kane, 56, also 56
today. Oh, he invented
today.
Raisin Canes.
Guy Ritchie.
The Gentleman.
The Gentleman.
And The Gentleman is coming back.
And
so.
What movie was he in, Bob?
Snatch.
Yeah.
He wasn't in it.
He directed it.
He directed it. It came from his brain.
What? Yeah.
Ugh. Also, Corby's favorite, Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels.
Hells yeah. With the great Vinnie Jones, who was also in The Gentleman.
Comedian right. Matt Rife is 29.
Also in Snatch.
Was he in?
Yep.
Was he in Snatch?
Sheck West.
And also in the Premier League.
I know. 26.
Oh, Sheck West?
They play
West?
That song at every single college football game.
Mo Bamba, indeed.
Born on this day, now dead.
Four.
We have Rin Tin Tin, the actor dog.
And you're right. Rough. That can be heard at every stadium now.
Three.
Philip Baker Hall dog. From Curb Your Enthusiasm.
White guy.
Roger Maris, whose hair fell
three.
Off.
Done and comedy for 20
Arnold
years
Palmer.
Now.
Who invented mixing tea and lemonade?
That's Damaris. No.
Down the State Still Dead, Harold Gillies, the
right
inventor
four.
Of plastic surgery. And that is why today doesn't suck.
Bye, Justin.
Shut it down.
Bye, Ian.
That was hilarious.
Bye, four.
Broadcasting live from the
Patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Come on. Come on. Here's Dave.
Thank you. Well, Corby is still here. He's fighting through it after learning that his hero has been unfaithful. Dave Grohl.
This segment's going to be about Dave Grohl.
55-year-old frontman of Foo Fighters, former drummer of Nirvana.
Foo Fighters.
Published a confession via social media today, revealing that he cheated on his wife.
Those are really harsh words. We don't know that.
Well, I quote, "I've recently become the father of a new baby daughter born outside of my marriage."
Oh, no.
"I plan to be a loving and supportive parent to her. I love my wife and my children, and I am doing everything I can to regain their trust and earn their forgiveness. We're grateful for your consideration towards all the children involved as we move forward together."
I mean...
Well, that's,
Corby Davidson.
It's Dave Grohl. What do you expect?
The nicest man in rock.
He is, but
like,
I mean...
Like, if you ask him to sleep with him, he's going to say yes.
Yeah, like, if you're a hot 25-year-old, why are you hitting on him? He's going to say yes.
So, he is currently married to his second wife. So, his first wife was Jennifer Lee Youngblood, and they were married from 94 to 97, so back in the Nirvana days.
Yeah.
And then...
That doesn't even count.
Yeah, and then they broke up when he admitted he cheated on her.
Eh, it's Nirvana.
Gary, that's disgusting.
He's a rock star. Come on.
What do you people want?
So he has been married to model Jordan Bloom since 2003. And they have three daughters, Violet, 18, Harper, 15, and Ophelia, 10. And so no doubt his daughters are asking, "Papa, why? Don't you love mama anymore?"
Yeah, it's probably tough on the old kiddos. God, I wish this was my
Jordan,
wife.
His wife, she is a handsome woman.
Well, what do you expect? You think Dave Grohl's going to have an ugly wife?
We don't know who the baby mama is. That has not been revealed.
That's what I'm most interested
in. I know.
In.
That's what we need to know.
And why wasn't it my wife? Like, I mean, he could have just...
Right,
he was just here a few months ago.
You could be co-parents with Dave Grohl.
Does that tweet in any way feel like it was written with perhaps someone looking over his shoulder?
This is what I don't understand. Why is he even saying anything? Like, is one of these two women, either the baby mama or the wife, is like, "I'm going to post everything if you don't do it." Like... Because there's no reason to do this. This is a private matter.
Well, he's talking about trying to regain their trust, and part of it is taking accountability.
But I mean, taking accountability doesn't mean you announce it to the world. When you're a celebrity, you have to.
Is the prepositional phrase outside of my marriage a weird way to announce a baby?
Is that what Jerry said?
That's what Dave Grohl just said. That's a weird... Yeah, Jerry probably didn't say it. Didn't work out any better. It felt like when Chipper Jones had his Hooters waitress
spot
issue, and I feel like he was somewhat forced by the little lady to have a press conference addressing it, and then I think she filed for divorce immediately thereafter.
Dave Grohl spent some time at Wimbledon over the summer.
Yes, he did.
He was there with his wife that he cheated on.
That is such a harsh word. Once again, Dave.
That he had a child out of wedlock against.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Against.
Against his wife. But yeah, people are saying...
Without her approval.
Yeah, people are looking back at video of them at Wimbledon and saying it's obvious that things are not right. That she,
how do you know
she's
what, why? Because that, he what, didn't have his hand up her skirt? Like,
well, that she's upset. You can tell, like, he has a kind of like the Ben Affleck thousand-yard stare, and she is giving him the cold shoulder. Anyway.
Well,
prayers up for Grohl.
Yeah, and he's 55 years old, as the big unit just texted me.
Oh. You have his number?
Randy Johnson?
Yes. Why doesn't Dave Grohl, why didn't he get a vasectomy? Like, what's he doing even with the opportunity and or threat of being able to have a kid at that age?
So now it's God's fault that he impregnated a woman that wasn't his wife.
No, it's Dave's fault for not getting a vasectomy.
Right, because then you can cheat without consequences.
And that's what you're endorsing here?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's what
on
Corby...
On this night of a presidential debate, this is what you want to say?
Those are Corby's family values.
Sounds like that he wouldn't be having this problem.
As bad a day as Dave Grohl is having, he's not having as bad a day as Sean Diddy Combs.
Man, that lucky kid.
Sean Diddy Combs had a $100 million sexual assault default judgment levied against him yesterday.
Whoa.
Puff Daddy!
Derek Lee Cardello Smith, a 51-year-old, filed this lawsuit, and he claims that Diddy drugged and sexually assaulted him in 1997 at a party in Detroit. And so Diddy failed to appear to the virtual hearing on Monday, so the judge issued a default decision of $100 million and a payment schedule of $10 million per month starting October 1st.
What kind of dough does he got?
I don't know, but
is $10 million a month enough to go through it, though?
Yeah. Well, and by the way, Cardello Smith is in jail right now. So Combs' attorney says this man is a convicted felon and sexual predator who's been sentenced on 14 counts of sexual assault and kidnapping over the last 26 years. Mr. Combs has never heard of him and looks forward to having this judgment dismissed. Mm-hmm. But in the suit, Cardello Smith says that he met Diddy while he was working at a restaurant in Detroit. The two met up with a group of women at a party, and then they were having sex with those women when Cardello Smith said he felt a male hand touching him, which he claims was Diddy. He then says Combs offered him a drink which was spiked with something, causing him to pass out. And then when he awoke, he saw Diddy having sex with a woman, and Combs looked over to him and said, "I did this to you, too."
I thought he was going to say, "Always bet on black."
Probably. Probably. Let's
high
see.
Five.
Never felt blacker.
Let's see.
That's a go-to move right now.
Larry David is going to be on the road. He is bringing a tour to 10 cities this fall, A Conversation with Larry David. This last leg of the tour kicks off on the 20th of September in Denver. Each show, he will have a mystery moderator, although the Denver event, it's not a mystery because it's going to be Peyton Manning. But evidently, these are an informal discussion about his time on Seinfeld, Curb, and everything in between. And would you like to hear how he sells it?
Yeah.
All right. Here's Larry.
Hello, I'm Larry David. Lucky me. So listen, there are some tickets going on sale for this thing I'm doing. It's really nothing. It'll be a total waste of your time. You know, there's not that many things to do at night. So, yeah, I guess if you have nothing to do. But you could consider bowling. It's not a terrible, I haven't done it in about 50 years. But now that I mention it, I think I might hit the lanes soon. Anyway, if you want to go, you go. If you don't, you don't. Not a big deal either way. Okay.
Typical Larry underselling everything. But if you want to see, the closest he's coming to Dallas is Austin, December 4th at Bass Concert Hall. The official trailer for The Apprentice came out today. The Sebastian Stan as Donald Trump biopic.
The movie.
And Jeremy Strong from Succession plays Roy Cohn, his kind of mentor. And so I think this is interesting because it does show how Roy Cohn shaped Trump into the man he became. Okay. So here's a little taste of that.
No matter what happens, you claim victory and never admit defeat.
You have to be willing to do anything to anyone to win.
You have a big ass. You gotta work on that.
Your face looked like an orange.
Attack, attack, attack.
Deny everything.
Admit nothing.
Never admit defeat.
What if you lost your fortune today?
Well, then maybe I'll run for president. I don't know.
Mm. Yeah, foreshadowing.
There's no point to
what's
that.
He up to
you just
these
wanted
days?
To play audio? Stop it, Ham.
Well, there's something on TV tonight, Bob. I don't know if you're going to watch that. The White Stripes, Jack White, and Meg White have filed suit against Donald Trump for flagrant misappropriation of Seven Nation Army. Jack posted the first page of the complaint on his Instagram with the caption, "This machine sues fascists."
I can't. I know that it's just a bit now. Like, they just pick songs that they know the artist is going to be
right.
Like, no. But I think it's even funny for their camp to do it, because all it is just kind of, they do it. They know they're going to get bit, but who cares?
Right.
Yeah. Pick a song, play it.
They did get ruled against by the Isaac Hayes estate, so that estate successfully barred the Trump campaign from using Hold On, I'm Coming. And not to be outdone, Harry Shearer, Derek Smalls of Spinal Tap, said Spinal Tap is demanding the Trump campaign refrain from playing Sex Farm at their rallies. I don't know that that was a problem, but they're just making sure.
All right, we got to go. Before we get to Moose, let us talk to our old buddy, who we haven't talked to in a while, but he's still alive. He's still kicking. He's still playing tennis, even though he's not playing basketball. It's Dirk Nowitzki.
Yeah.
Hi, Dirk.
Hey, guys. I don't want to make the Moose wait.
He'll wait.
Sure you want. Let's do this.
He'll wait for you, Dirk.
We're great.
That's so sweet.
We're great. Hey, how you doing? How's the health?
Hey, thanks for having me. No, all good. Traveled a bunch this summer. Obviously, we'll always go to Europe and see family, and so it's good. We literally just got back in town like a week ago or so. So it was a fun summer, and feel good.
So we're in the before we get to your event, we're staring squarely at the basketball season, and I know last season had to be fun for you. It was fun for all of us. I don't know if I can remember a time, maybe going back to even like 2005, 2006, 2007, that I've been more excited for a basketball season with the potential. Do you look at it that way too?
Yeah, I mean, we are looking strong. We had a fun run there in the playoffs. It was fun to watch. We have a good group. It looked like the atmosphere and the chemistry was great there with the guys. So that was a lot of fun to watch. And I just think at the end we ran out of gas a little bit. And Boston was, of course, a very strong team. But I really like the additions that we made. Obviously, with Clay, sort of fit in great. I like the Marshall kid, who brings some toughness, some athleticism after losing Jones Jr. So I think we have a good group, a good core that that we can build on for the next 2 years. And, you know, as you guys know, an NBA season is a long grind. But if everybody stays healthy, I think we should make another run at it.
I want to go back to your summer and ask you how your Olympics were, because I feel like you spent a fair amount of time in Paris, didn't you?
Yes. I was a week in Paris. It was fun. You know, I'm on the board of FIBA, the International Basketball Federation, so we are in charge of putting on the basketball tournament for the Olympics. And so I was there, watched basically the whole last week, starting from the quarterfinals on. It was a fun tournament, I got to say, basketball-wise. Some great competition. Serbia was right there with the USA in the semifinals, almost beat them. And then obviously the heroics from Steph and many others. So basketball-wise, and even the women's game, which everybody thought U.S. will just run away easily. It was a competitive game all the way in the end against France, and the atmosphere. Obviously, it helped that both hosts were in the final. It was really a great tournament, so I was happy to be there. And really, overall, the atmosphere in Paris was great. I'm not sure what you guys saw on TV, but anywhere, other events that I went, the arenas were full. The traffic wasn't as bad as people were expecting. So I had a great time. The weather wasn't too hot. So I got to say it was a great turnout in Paris, and everybody had a great time.
Did you get to see Ray Gun in person?
No.
The break dancer.
Yeah, no, I know where the venue was because that was close to the 3x3 thing. So I missed the break dancing, but I went to some other cool stuff like table tennis and handball and all some other sports where some Germans were good and I was supporting. But I missed the break dancing. I saw plenty of it on social media.
Yeah, your dad was a legendary handball player, right? That's one of those games that is hard for us to understand as Americans.
If you would listen to him, he would say legendary. I would not say he was legendary. He was good local player. I think he even won Athlete of the Year in my hometown in Würzburg 1 year. He was so proud. My whole childhood, every time I said something about what I was doing in sports, he just pointed to that trophy. So he was a good little athlete there locally in my hometown. And handball is a fun sport, though. For some reason, it's not big here in the U.S. They play a little bit up in the Northeast, I think. But in Europe, it's huge. I mean, it's basically soccer with the hands. And it's such a fun sport. I played it growing up all the way till I was about 12 or 13. And it's a fun sport. And Germany just won silver for the men's in the Olympic tournament. So I was there for the semifinal. And it was awesome.
Well, so, you got your big tournament coming up here once again to benefit the Dirk Nowitzki Foundation. It's this Saturday, the Dirk Nowitzki Tennis Classic, presented by Chime. It's at TBRM, the legendary tennis club right there off of right off 635 in Preston on Dilbeck Lane. This Saturday, from doors open at 2, the exhibition starts at 3. And dude, you've been doing this for a long time, and I've been to it a couple of times, and it's an absolute blast.
It's fun. We brought it back, obviously, last year with Hall of Fame and then Basketball World Cup. I was a little busy, so I didn't have time to put it on. But we're back at a new venue this year, and it's a little different format. We only do it one show court, so everybody is able to lock in and watch some of the celebs that are coming. And it's always a great event for, you know, for family and kids. And so it should be another fun event. We've got some cool people coming out. Nashi's coming, JJ Barea's coming again. We got Coco Vandeweghe coming, to form a top 20 female player. We got Dr. Phil playing. Clay's coming out to support and swing the racket a bit. So I think it should be a fun event. So coming out this Saturday and enjoy. And you know me, I love tennis, so I'm going to be out there a little bit and all hyped and excited from watching U.S. Open for 2 weeks. So we'll see if I can recreate some of those shots.
How did you, okay, the outlier here.
There's so many questions about Dr. Phil.
It's Dr. Phil. How did this happen?
So Dr. Phil is an avid tennis player and a tennis fan, and I've actually played with him over the last 2 years here in retirement. and he loves it. And so I just flat out asked him if he wanted to come and support. And he said he'll play a tiebreaker too. So I've known him for a few years now. nice guy, super nice guy. And like I said, a huge, huge tennis fan. So I can't wait for him to come out.
How's Nash's game?
Nash is, I mean, I don't want to blow smoke, but he started. He never played it growing up, so he just started after retirement. So he started about 8, 9, 10 years ago now, and he's unbelievable. His strokes look like he's learned it like as a junior, and he's gotten better from year to year. I mean, he plays, he's addicted. I mean, he plays probably 5, 6 times a week, and so he's just a crazy athlete, which...
Of course.
Which I wouldn't tell him, but yeah, he's incredibly good. You'll see on Saturday. Sure.
How is your ankle? How are you getting around the court?
You know, better. I wouldn't say I'll be a sprinter anytime soon, but, you know, I think finally I started settling in. You know, the first 2 years, I didn't want to work out. I didn't want to, you know, watch what I eat. And now the last 2 years, I'd say I found a little better rhythm on how to take care of my body and how to live for the next whatever 40-50 years. So it's okay, it's good. I've done some stuff, I tried some treatments, and just being in a routine, being on a regular schedule again definitely helps. So I will unfortunately never be running or jumping up and down a basketball court anytime soon again, but at least it allows me to have some fun and play some tennis, play some paddle or padel, how they call it in Europe. We play that a lot now, which is a super fun sport. So just trying to stay active and enjoy the family lifestyle.
This is our hero, Dirk. And
so sweet.
Well, you know it's true. you know you're forever in our hearts.
And, I mean, is there anything better than seeing Dirk courtside?
Only getting to walk past his statue every day.
That's true.
I stop and reflect.
I talk to you every day, Dirk. I just walk up and have a conversation.
So sweet. So you've been 7 feet tall for quite a while, although mm-hmm. I suppose when you get old, you might start shrinking a little bit. But for now, we feel like you're still 7 feet tall. One great mm-hmm. thing about seven-footers is they are constantly asked to take pictures with short people mm-hmm. just to demonstrate how different humans can be. And yeah. I remember your meeting with Simone Biles a long time ago. I think you were still mm-hmm. a player, right?
We met with I don't think Simone was there that day, but we met with the rest of the gymnastics team.
Well, you have a picture with her, so on the practice court, you should Google yourself.
I do remember the whole team was there. I couldn't remember if Simone was there.
Well, I'm only comparing that to your new picture with a short Olympian. That is Sha'Carri Richardson in Paris found you at a basket. At the men's final. This is where you took that picture.
For sure.
Now, she's significantly taller than Simone. I think she's like 5'2". Instead of Simone's
is
forehead.
Is she that? Yeah. They that short?
I believe so. I don't know.
Wow, that's fast for that short.
Did you post her up, Dirk?
I tried. Well, she's pretty strong, I got to say. She got into my legs, you know. No, it was so sweet. It was so nice. And she came up to me. She said, "You're a Dallas hero." And, you know, and watching me growing up. And so she was so sweet. We talked for a little bit and took the photo. So that was super cool. Actually, overall at the Olympics, I met so many cool current athletes, ex-athletes, some guys I competed with a long time ago. So it was just, it's almost like a little reunion, and it was fun to be there.
Is it? I'm curious. First of all, and you don't have to admit either way. I would imagine Europe's finest, probably at least quietly, roots that somebody can give the USA a run for their money, and maybe even knock them out in the Olympics. And then you can comment on that if you like. But really, what I want to ask you is: was the show Steph put on in the final 2 minutes about the best thing you've ever seen?
Oh, yeah, Steph is insane. I mean, I knew right away that he was going to try to shoot the next one. And then when he made that one, I knew he was going to shoot the next one. Obviously, we've watched him for a long, long time. And, I mean, just Steph being Steph, honestly, we've seen it, obviously, in the NBA and finals on the biggest stages. So we all knew what he can do. But it was still every time he does something, you're like, you're almost amazed. Like, this kid is unbelievable. And couldn't happen, obviously, to a better guy. And rooting I think some Europeans want to see the U.S. lose, but it was just, honestly, I was so happy that it was a great tournament and somebody challenged the U.S. It wasn't a blowout every game. They had to fight for it. And so best case scenario is that the U.S. won, especially for me living in the U.S. I think I would never heard the end of it if that team with some of the goats of our now modern game, they would have gotten beat. I don't think I would have heard the end of it. So I was actually surprised that some of these games got so close. I mean, the U.S. sent some incredible talent and some of the best that we had in our game. And still, the FIBA game is just different. The court's smaller, the game's shorter. And you can see sometimes it's harder to adjust. There's not as much room to operate. And so it was a lot closer than I thought before the tournament. But I'm still happy the U.S. won, and I didn't get too much flack for it.
Now, before we let you go, could you have envisioned any time in your playing career that Mark Cuban would give up control of that team?
No, and I said that last year. To me, that came completely out of nowhere. I had no idea. But, Mark never really told me about it, so I got to take whatever he said in the press about it. I guess he got his reasons for it. I never saw that coming. I mean, the Mavs are is obviously heart and soul, and what he's put in there the last 20, 25 years, obviously it's been amazing. So, sometimes stuff happens, and now you just got to make the best out of it. And he's still around, obviously, as you saw in the playoffs, he was there. At almost every game, and we'll see. Obviously, I've met Patrick, been around him a few times now. Seems like a super, super nice man, and he wants to do well, just like Mark. He cares. He wants to have winners here, and he wants to make Mavericks the champions. So I think his heart's in the right place, and we'll see where this goes the next 2 years. But I gotta say, we have a heck of a team, and I can't wait for the new season.
All right, bro. Great having you on as always, and we'll post everything up on our social media and tag you. You can retweet everything, and everybody go out to TBRM this Saturday and check out the Dirk Nowitzki Tennis Classic. Back at it once again, benefiting his foundation. Man, have fun this Saturday, and we'll talk to you very soon, man.
And how about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys?
Moose will go into detail, but, I'll just tell you, I see Dak back. We got CD signed. We brought Zeke back. I mean, let's go. This is our year, guys. I'll let Moose take it from here.
There you go, man.
You're awesome, dude.
All right. Thank you, guys. We'll
see you,
talk soon.
All right, bud. There he goes.
Here is Dave.
Well, I don't know if you remember this story, but this was from August of 2022, there was a gentleman named Donald Arthur Gruber, a 66-year-old dude. And on August 7th, 2022, he and his passenger, Peggy Cox, crashed his truck into a home in White Settlement and ended up killing Katie June Kirkland, who was a student at Saginaw High School.
She was in the house?
She was sleeping, or she was in her room, and the car, the truck, went through her bedroom.
Were they drunk?
Yes. Yeah, so Katie June Kirkland was killed in her room. Her father was seriously injured. And so Gruber and his passenger were overserved at a local bar before getting behind the wheel the night of the crash. And
how do you run into a house?
Well, there were, Donald Arthur Gruber claimed that Peggy Cox, that they were, I guess, having a fight in the car, and she grabbed the steering wheel and caused him to swerve, and then they plowed into the house.
Yeah, if I had a nickel.
Amy Kirkland is Katie's mother. And she said that the crash has taken everything from her. Her family's home was destroyed. Her daughter obviously was killed, her only child. And her husband was left in a coma for months, and he's been permanently affected. He had to relearn how to walk.
Good gracious.
Like, it's just been a terrible ordeal for this family. And so Donald Arthur Gruber was charged with intoxication manslaughter, and he was set to appear in court tomorrow. He had been found to have violated the conditions of his bond by drinking alcohol. So he just can't...
He's not in jail?
Well, he had bonded out. He was awaiting trial.
I don't get it.
But he had violated the conditions of his bond by drinking alcohol. So he was supposed to be in court on Wednesday, tomorrow. Well, on Saturday, about 4:10 a.m., police say that 4:10 a.m. on August 31st, they responded to a report in the 9100 block of Nathan Drive. A caller reported a shooting, and so officers responded, and they found Donald Arthur Gruber in the yard with a gunshot wound to his head. He ended it before having to face the family in court. He took the coward's way out.
Yeah.
So the mother, Amy Kirkland, said, "I don't want to say I was looking forward to the trial, but I wanted the trial to happen so that he could face his punishment. And now he will not."
Off. Dang.
Yeah.
You really brought the room down there.
Well, maybe we're better off without him. Maybe we can look at it that way.
Indeed. Here's a bizarre shooting story from Saturday night involving Dallas police. So this was in the 3100 block of Norwalk Avenue in Dallas. Not sure what neighborhood that is, but officers responded to the call of an armed man attempting to break into apartments. Plural, I guess. He was just trying to go from apartment to apartment, trying to get in. Witnesses told 911 operators that the suspect was trying to break into a second floor apartment armed with a handgun and appeared to be intoxicated. So officers come out to the apartment complex and they find the suspect and they ask him to show his hands in English and in Spanish. And instead, the suspect pulled a handgun from his waistband. And so officers opened fire and killed him. Turns out the gun was a replica. It was not even a real gun.
Why are you pulling it?
I mean, obviously he was out of his mind drunk.
Why are you carrying a replica gun? What does that even mean? Like a toy?
Well, so Dallas police issued images of the gun and it looks like a real...
Yeah, I would imagine.
Like a magazine handgun.
I would imagine that's not super uncommon because you can bluff your way in a lot
of
situations.
If you're just trying to
you could
B and E or just trying to carjack somebody or
rob a convenience store
someone,
with a fake gun.
Yeah. You're not anticipating having to use it. And so if it looks real, you can get away with using
it.
Okay. But
are you
why
still
would you
charged
ever show it to an
a cop,
officer?
Yeah. Because you're an idiot. If you rob a bank with a gun made of soap, okay? Smells nice, I'm sure. But
yes,
you carve
you
it out of soap.
Can't get it wet.
Right. It would really
slip right out of your hand, skitter across the floor.
And you get away with it, and then they catch you. And they charge you. Is it armed?
They make you eat it.
You're right. Wash your mouth out with it.
Assault with a foamy weapon?
You know what I'm saying? Do you get charged?
That's not a charge.
Do you get charged just like you would if you had a real gun? With an armed
probably
robbery?
Not. There has to be a name for it, right? If you are threatening someone with a toy gun as if it's a real gun, do you get the same gun charges? I imagine no, but I guess I don't have any idea. I'm willing to roll screenless on this.
Like a soap gun
or a stick gun. You know plenty of officers of the law.
I do.
You can get to the bottom
of
this.
I'll get to the bottom of this unless somebody can do it faster.
Okay. A couple of quick hits in the world of education. This first one from Arlington ISD. At Goodman Elementary School, an employee on Friday was accused of tying students up with string and putting tape over their mouths.
As punishment?
I guess because they couldn't control them, because they just needed them to settle down.
Woodman Elementary?
Goodman.
Goodman.
Yeah, so the district was alerted to the allegations on Friday, and they immediately started an investigation and placed the employee on administrative leave and let the parents of the involved students know. So they do not know, or I guess they have not revealed what the employee's role at the school is or was, whether it's a teacher or, I don't know, an administrator. But they said that they will provide additional details after they conclude the investigation. Arlington police have said that there is no criminal investigation because there's not been a police report issued. But can you imagine being so out of control as an elementary school teacher that you have to bind and gag your students?
Dude, it would seem this would be the end of the educator's career.
Yeah, you can't outrun that.
No. Like, how do you... And how old are these kids? Like, if you were in sixth grade and your teacher tried to tie you up, I'd be like, look, hon, I don't think this is going to happen.
Look, sweetie.
Yeah, I just don't see you tying me up. Tying me up!
With string.
Like, why not send him to the principal? That's what the principal's like
office is
there
for. They just went into the craft closet and got some yarn to tie them up.
And did they get masking tape? Did they get scotch tape?
Yeah, how many pieces of scotch tape do you need to tape a kid's mouth shut?
Yeah.
And in Fort Worth, a rough weekend for the folks at Tender Love Child Care in Arlington.
Okay, Tender Love Child Care.
Yeah.
Did one of the kids walk out onto highway or something?
Like a preschool. So, as of Friday, everything was fine. The school's bus was parked behind the building, everything was fine, but by Saturday morning, the bus was gone. So they reported it stolen. Then, finally, Fort Worth police see the stolen bus on Sunday, and they try to get the bus driver to pull over.
I drove bus.
The bus driver refuses to stop. So this is, this is on Monday, around 2:30 in the afternoon. They try to pull over this bus, and the driver refuses to stop, so they chase this preschool bus through like six different neighborhoods. Finally, they end up on Silver Trail in Grand Prairie, at which point a couple of the people in the bus bail out and lead police on a foot chase. There were six cop cars chasing this bus at some point. Finally, they arrest two people that were inside the bus, and so they let the school owners know, hey, we found your bus. And they're like, oh my God, thank you. So they go and they check out the bus. Well, not only did somebody steal it overnight on Friday, they basically moved in. That when they found the bus,
Chris McCandless,
there were piles of clothes, food, trash, alcohol. They said, whatever you think of, they just moved in there.
Yeah.
And
smart.
That all of the seats now have to be replaced. And I guess they were tagging the inside of it. She said there's paint all over the bus.
Was it multiple people that were living there, or just some rogue, like the Simpsons?
Two people were arrested.
Okay.
So two people stole the bus and were living inside this preschool bus, at least for 2 days. They got two good days out of it.
Kind of awesome. Like, no harm, no foul, outside of maybe, I hope they didn't use it as like a
potty?
Yes. Surely they had the... That's their home, though. Yeah. They're not going to treat their home that way.
Well, they probably had a bucket.
Did they put up shades or anything? Did they go to home decor and, like, buy things to spruce it up?
Or maybe just aluminum foil?
Right. Smear it. You're gross. All right. That's good stuff.
Get the Steak podcast daily at patreon.com/sportsgreek.